All right, well, today I was actually going to council today. So the reason why I was going to council today is because I feel absolutely terrible today. And the reason why is I feel very belligerent and wrathful. So if anyone of you want to cross me today, you'll find yourself getting some back today. Which might be a bit different, huh? What's been coming up for me is a lot of emotions about humanity not understanding love and things like that, and I've got quite a bit of rage inside of me about all of that. So I'm actually working my way through that over the next few months, I would say it's going to take me. Although that being said, sometimes I get through things quite rapidly if I just allow them to happen freely. So today, my apologies in advance if you find me a little belligerent at times. The other thing I wanted to do today, rather than talk a lot, is to actually give you all the opportunity to ask questions about our first century lives. And when I say our, I would like to introduce you to a friend of mine, Cornelius, and from the first century. So can you stand up, Cornelius, so everyone can see you?
Hi.
And Cornelius will be joining me, which he can do now.
Okay.
And what we would like to do is perhaps allow you to ask any questions you want about our first century lives. Now bear in mind that we're still working through our emotions with regard to our first century lives. So that means, just like when you work through your emotions, do you know when you haven't worked through an emotion yet, you usually don't have the memory yet. And then when you work through the emotion, then you get the memory. Well, that's what it's exactly like for us as well. So when we work through different emotions, we have different memories. So we don't have a complete recall of all of our first century lives. And I probably have a fair majority of it now. But Corny's probably about halfway there, I'd say, maybe.
Not even that.
And so bear that in mind when you're asking these questions. What I would like to do first is to tell you how I met Cornelius.
Now?
No, in the first century.
Okay.
In the first century, I used to see him in the distance quite a lot, surrounding when I was publicly preaching.
Do you want to tell them who I was?
I'd like to tell them how I met you first.
Oh, I'm sorry, yeah.
Two rubbies.
Yeah, that's right. So what happened was that he would quite often be in the distance because he was a centurion who was an army leader of a Roman legion that was based in Jerusalem. And, well, they're based in Caesarea, but he lived in Jerusalem. And what happened was that he would often be present at the discussions that I'd have in front of thousands of people, and I'd notice him. So, you know how it is sometimes you get people going along there for crowd control and they finish up getting involved. Well, what happened is that I could notice Cornelius slowly, like, listening to the things that were being presented over time. And then there's a lot more I could tell you, but you can ask questions about that. How we met this time around, do you want to tell them that?
It's a bit of a long story, kind of. Just like one of these sort of groups that was held. I'm from Western Australia, and there's another one, the 14 Apostles of John. I didn't know at the time anything about that. Just some friends told me there's good discussions go on there, and so sort of on that path, and just went over to see one of these discussion things, and all the stuff was pretty good, and I was a bit curious about where John got all this stuff from. Thought it was quite good, and there's some things I didn't like about it. And so I was asking him about it, and he says, from a friend called AJ, so I want to see what this AJ guy was about as well. Just want to see where the truth kept following it back, where it come from, the source. And eventually caught up with, did I catch up with you then or not? It wasn't actually the group or something. John had a botanical gardens, he had a function thing on there, and to come around later on there'd be plenty of food if you want to come just help clean up. So I like food, so I went and just helped him clean up. And AJ had actually come from somewhere with Nate and Kate, Luke and Sarah, from the first century thing too, which I knew nothing about really as well. I didn't actually at that time, because I was sitting around later on and John was using both names, Nate and Kate, which is Luke and Sarah, and he kept on swapping their names, and one of the other ladies picked that up. I didn't. And she asked him what that's about, and explained about reincarnation thing. We thought there was no reincarnation. Doesn't happen, apparently, according to what you're saying. So that brought up some stuff, and then when the ladies asked AJ about, are you reincarnated, and he just sort of smiled and said yes, and she asked, who are you, and he just smiled as he does, and she just answered it for herself, and he just smiled again. And I thought, yeah, another, the 16th one this month, another Jesus, yeah, right, okay. I got kind of a bit pissed off at that, actually, and just walked off and went to the toilet, come back, and just thinking, I'm out of here. And they went off and had dinner, and I thought, I'm not coming back to this mob again. And I got quite sort of angry about, like, what's this guy up to? And just thought, so I'd done a lot of emotional work before that, and you end up in quite a vulnerable place, and didn't, in that place, it, people can be exploited. A lot of some people exploit people like that, which is absolutely disgusting. I think it's just probably one of the, it's probably one of the worst things you can do, sort of thing. I just didn't know if that was his job or what. Or his, not his job, like what he's up to. I just wanted to find out the truth. So I went and saw John, talked about my troubles with him, what was going on, and realised my problems with AJ. So when he came over next time, I caught up with him, spoke to him for about 4 hours, with a pretty much, I'm going to catch you out mood. I was asking more questions, and then he was quite honest, which sort of shocked me with all the questions I was asking. I was waiting for answers if I'd catch him on, but he's just been so honest. And in the end, he sort of pointed out a few things for me. They're not saying directly, but I realised I didn't have a lot of trust and stuff about things. And he pointed out a movie to watch. It might be good for me, The Notebook, which you probably all watched.
Yeah.
And had a lot of reactions out of that. I thought, how do you know that? And just wanted, I stayed away for quite a while, though, but about a couple of months or something. Mm. And just kept on bugging me because there's so much truth in there that resonated, yet there's other things I couldn't come to terms with myself. But I eventually just went back, sort of slowly just started listening a bit more and things like that, and kind of got to know him a bit more then.
When we had our four-hour discussion, Corny told me about a lot of his memories that he'd been having over the previous 10 to 12 years.
I didn't know anything about any of this, like my identity sort of thing then, at all.
So he was relating all these memories, and I could feel who he was already, but I didn't say to him who he was at all, and I just let him come to his own conclusions.
That's one thing actually I respect from you, because right from that moment you knew I had trouble with trust, and you've respected that ever since, never told me anything.
Mm.
Just let me work it out for myself, because I know I'll only trust what I feel.
Mm.
It might be wrong at the time, but I'll still trust it. Rather from somebody else, there's only one person to blame in the end.
So, So for us meeting the second time, I felt like a deep love for Corny as soon as I met him, but he couldn't feel that because of the trust issues that he had and so forth. So, but he also felt quite a lot of anger and stuff with me, which he couldn't understand either. Why would he be angry with somebody who was just talking to him about truth, you know? So there was those issues as well. So we're happy to answer any of your questions, particularly about the first century, if you want. This is a good time for you to have a chance to have a bit of a history lesson, if you want to have one, about what actually happened back then instead of what everybody thinks happened back then. In respect to our two lives, separately or together. And I know I've sort of put you all on the spot with this one, but I thought it would give you an opportunity just to voice some of your feelings, and also to voice some of the questions that you've been having about all of those kind of subjects, about what happened back then. So,
thanks. About your... No, I've forgotten. Oh, I read something or heard something recently where they said that Mary was in fact Joseph's second wife, and that you had step-siblings, so to speak, as well as siblings. Full siblings, I suppose. Is there
any... No, Mary, Joseph was a young man when Mary married her, not an old man. There's a common conception now that Joseph was an older man when my mum married him. But she married him, both of them were quite young. They fell in love in Nazareth. That was the hometown of my mother. And the hometown of my father was down south near Bethany. And so... he travelled up north to do work. He was an artisan, a builder, and they met there and fell in love. And I was the eldest of eight children altogether. So they weren't my half brothers or half sisters or anything like that. They were my full brothers and sisters. So I had five brothers and two sisters.
Another thing I heard too was that the marriage between them was under Jewish law. She could be called your birth could have been called a virgin birth because she got pregnant before they were officially married. And other things I've read or seen have said something like that you may have been the result of, Jesus may have been the result of rape from a Roman
Yeah, no, none of those things are true. What actually happened was that they got married, and I was the first child that came along about 9 months later. It was common to call a woman who had yet to marry a virgin, and even before she gave birth to the first child, because when you gave birth to your first child, it was then known that you were no longer a virgin, obviously. The reason why there's a lot of things surrounding this virgin birth thing is because they wanted to try and make me into some kind of God-begotten son, and all of that is wrong. That's not exactly what happened. Obviously, Mum and Dad had sex, just like all of you created your children in the same way, and that was the situation for them too, like exactly the same. There was no rape of my mother in the entire time that I was on earth, and so you know her relationship with my dad was quite strained, particularly after my death, because my father felt lots of guilt, and so he actually went through preaching through Europe, basically the truth through Europe, and he left my mum to do that, and he never returned. He died in England, so.
And part of the Bible, it says that an angel appeared before Mary and told her she was pregnant.
Yeah, that's not the case.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the third...
Go on.
At the birth, it talks about the three wise men.
Yeah.
Was that...
That was true.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, what happened was that there were three Chaldean philosophers and astrologers who noticed there were certain astrological events occurring at the time of my birth, and they felt that that meant the birth of the Messiah, and they came from Babylon, they went across to the desert to Jerusalem, and finished up tracking me down just after my birth in Bethlehem, and they didn't give any major valuable thing, but they actually talked to my father about why they'd come, and that they felt that I was the Messiah that was foretold in the Bible. So that was actually true, and they were motivated actually by spirits in the spirit world who knew about the event and who were assigned to actually protect me as part of my guides and guardians protecting me in the first century.
So they're sort of portrayed now as being from three different countries or something, but they all came from one place.
Yeah, they all came from the one place.
So they probably were talking amongst each other and decided to set off together.
Yeah, they set off together. They originally rocked up at Herod's, who was the procurator. He wasn't the procurator. He was a self-styled king of the area of there were one of Israel was divided into four areas, and he was the self-styled king of one of those areas, and they first rocked up to him and mentioned the king of the Jews, and. He, of course, became very concerned about that, which actually resulted in the slaughter of around 20 children in Bethlehem shortly after my parents left.
Thank you.
So if you are just a normal birth, were you doing healings? And if so, how did that happen for you if you were an ordinary person?
First thing I want to address, I am an ordinary person. Always. I am an ordinary person. Just like you are an ordinary person, I'm an ordinary person too.
What a relief.
What a relief, yeah. Second thing is that all gifts come from one of two sources. All gifts come from either a spirit who is connecting with you, who gives you the gift, or through God's love entering you to the point of at-one-ment where you automatically have the gifts. So in my case, what happened was that I couldn't heal until I entered the at-one-ment stage, which occurred when I was around 30 years of age. So up until that time, I could heal just the same as any one of you could heal, or I can heal right now via spirit helping. But when I was 30 years of age, I no longer needed that to occur.
How did that happen for you then at 30?
What happened? Well, it's not like an event that just happened like that. For the previous 20 years, I'd been practicing all of the things that I'm teaching you over the past 6 months or so to get into an at-one-ment condition with God. Once you get into an at-one-ment condition with God, all of a sudden all of these different gifts are open up to you. Because you enter a new state, and the soul enters a new state when you're in that condition. So all of you will have all of those same abilities once you enter that state. You follow me? Mm-hmm. And so it's important to understand that it's the state is an overcloaking by God, basically. So in other words, God's love overcloaks you, it surrounds you, and it changes everything that you do, and the power in everything that you do.
Why would they keep that hidden when that's such exciting.
Well, because the reason why they kept it hidden in the Bible was because there was the priesthood had a strong desire to create an elite class compared to the laity class. Everything to do with the priesthood in the Bible is about control. So every time the priesthood got a hold of a truth, they would manipulate it in such a way that the laity would become dependent upon the priesthood for the gift to be given. And as soon as you enter that state, obviously, you know, that's an error state, but that's why it happened, because the priesthood wanted to maintain that they had control of these gifts from God, and obviously that's not true, but it's something that they maintain. And because nobody had ever done their emotional work to the point of one-ment with God, everyone started to get a little bit, I suppose you could say, down and depressed about whether you could even do it ever. And so what they did was they decided that the way it was described in the previous writings couldn't be correct. And so what they did was modify the previous writings. And by the time 300 years after my birth, by that time, quite a lot of those things that actually happened in the first century were distorted so much that it was hard to tell the truth from the falsehood.
Yeah. And what were the biggest distortions?
Well, the biggest distortion was that they made me God. So that was the biggest distortion. You know, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost, these three are one, is the major distortion that occurred at 300, or 325 it was. But the reason why they did that was because they wanted to try and understand why I had these gifts that nobody else had. But they also wanted to try to impact upon what they called pagan religions. And a lot of the pagan religions had also these fanciful, mystical things that have happened to each one of their leaders. And so they wanted to compare me with those leaders by making my life more mystical than theirs. In reality, all it did was distort the truth so much that in the end, people just didn't understand the truth anymore at all. So that's the biggest one. The biggest one was that particular one. And that's the one that disappointed me the most. And still does, actually. And many of you have this concept of me right now inside of you, which is in error, because of those beliefs about Jesus that come from all sorts of teachings through your life. Right? Many of you still don't look at me. When I say Jesus, you have this vision of some unique, special individual that there's only one of in the universe, and nobody else can ever be in that state. And the truth is that's not right. And that the whole reason why I came to teach was so that everyone would understand that everyone can get into that state. Right? So it's very, very important that you understand that. You'll find that many of your questions even surround an emotional injury that you have within you, unbeknown to you, coming from your childhood about what you were taught about Jesus and beliefs in the New Age movement about Jesus and so forth, rather than who I really am. can we confine these questions to first century life or this life in terms of me and Cornelius? Because there'll be opportunities to answer all those other kinds of questions later. Yeah. No, not
behind me.
Sorry, James. Yeah.
So can you tell us about the death and the rebirth story?
The death and the rebirth story?
You know, the rolling back of the stone and the body
and the stone. Certainly. Yeah. Can I stop talking? Can someone ask Corny a question? because I just need to have a bit of a rest for a second.
I was just wondering.
So,
from your memory.
Which one's going?
Okay.
From your memory now of what was happening when you were watching AJ or Christ talking to thousands and you were proud of God, what the progression of your beliefs and reactions to it was over time?
Hell, you probably gave the state I was in at that time too, which was not a very good place at all.
Excuse me, could you speak louder, please? I cannot hear you.
Yeah, I'm pretty quiet speaker. I'll do my best. I'll take you just a quick journey through the life, I suppose, to see where it ended up, to where that state was. I was a normal child and stuff like that, and at the age of 5, soldiers come to... Oh, gosh, look at this.
So were you actually from the area?
I was in,
let him answer the question.
I was taken by soldiers at the age of 5 and for the Roman forces then. I was born in Sicily, and that's where I was taken on that island there. And just pretty much... there's lots of kids like that too. I didn't realise till recently about that. And they just pretty much detuned you emotionally. They're raped and beaten and... just all that sort of stuff, you know, typical soldier things they do to people just to make them dehumanise them, I suppose. And then, just had this big loss of love from my mother and family and stuff, and just kept on hoping that someone would come and take me home. And that never happened. And then, just sort of hold on to hope, and then just... To me, it felt like it was a rock, the only rock I had to hold myself together, and then it slowly wore away to like a stone, then just a pebble, and just in some moment, just all realised it's never ever going to happen, and just everything fell apart, and just succumbed to where I had to be. But there was a lot of rage and anger inside me towards my mum, particularly, but also towards all the soldiers, towards everybody, really, and so I became a pretty nasty person. I forwarded off. To that time, when I saw this guy standing around talking, I just started to just this small glimmer of hope was still left in my heart about love. It's still a concept, mate. I just thought it was all bullshit. It's just a bullshit concept. It's just a lie. It's just a total lie. But then when I heard him speaking, it just started to resonate with something in me. I didn't know what, and just go away in my own little times when I had time to myself, usually sleep time, I suppose, and just like. Some things would come up, was starting to stir things, and I didn't understand it, and to go and sort of hearing more, and just started stirring a lot of stuff up inside of me, and realising, you know, everything that's happened, I suppose, and what I've become, because I wasn't a nice person at all either. I'd kill people, innocent people, rape people as well, hurt children, all from the anger that was, like, I obviously didn't know how to deal with it, and just had such rage at the world. Didn't want any. If I couldn't be happy, no one could be happy. It's not possible. It's not real. And I've actually had some spirits come back now that I start to accept my identity a bit more, and had a sense about them. They've come and like one of them is really still angry with me, still in a bad spot 2,000 years ago. There's a lady as well that I raped back then. She was still in a bad state, but she's doing pretty good now after talking and stuff. But it's just tough to. Seeing him, I suppose, it started to stir things up and started to change me a little bit inside. Started looking at my emotional side, I suppose, again. It still just was pretty much a flame gone out, but it was just a little spark left on the wick that came up again.
The Roman army used to take children from their parents who they felt would have good genetic stock at a very, very young age and basically beat them and rape them and do all sorts of things to just dehumanise them into just a fighting machine. And that was basically Corny's upbringing, if you like, from the age of 5 onwards.
what age were you when you first saw a Christ and was doing the crowd control?
This dude?
What age were you when you first?
There's time in Syria for a while in the Balkans, and come down to Caesarea. Just political stuff going on, which brought a lot of the troops into Jerusalem. They usually had auxiliary troops that didn't need proper forces there. Right. So there's some political stuff going on that required them. And from Syria, it's somewhere like. Oh, I don't know for sure, I don't really care about ages, but it would have been around probably in the low 30s, so I died at 34. Yeah.
You see some experience if you were in the position you were in.
Yeah, because I was only from Syria, that's when I became an optio, which is a sergeant, and then from not long after that, became a centurion.
Corny was a huge man, like, he was 6'4", and even more solid than he is now, and had his huge hands. I just remember his hands a lot from...
I remember yours too.
And, he was just this huge fighting machine, really.
He would have been standing a foot taller than anybody at the back of the crowd.
Well, back then too, people were generally a lot shorter than they are now.
Yeah.
So to be 6'4" back then was like you were a giant, you know. Yeah, just, you know, he was bigger than two ordinary men, and but muscle.
Corny, can you tell us something about your conversion process or your decision to teach and afterwards?
Teach? I didn't teach anybody. Nah.
Did you make any decision after your experiences with Jesus that?
Well, perhaps we should skip back and answer the lady's question about my own death, and then, it's all related as to what happened to Corny as well. So what we'll try to do is we'll describe these events from both of our perspectives, because we were both obviously involved in those, in the events leading up to my death. So I'll start about a week before my death. I felt I needed to be in Jerusalem. It was the time of the Passover, and I just felt that it was a good time for me to be there. I also had a feeling that things perhaps weren't going to be as good as what I'd hoped them to be. But what was happening behind the scenes is many of the so-called disciples and apostles were not understanding the message that I had. And they also felt, as do many people today actually still feel, that I don't know what I'm talking about as much as I should know. And so they had this feeling that, you know, they wanted me to be the king of the Jews still on earth. And so they started to actually organize some things behind the scenes without my being aware. And what they would try to do is they would try to organize conflicts between myself and the Jewish Sanhedrin. And so that sort of come to a peak during that week of the Passover being in Jerusalem. On the day of my arrest, I'd spent most of the day in Jerusalem speaking in the temple, and there were huge amounts of outcries because a few days earlier I'd caused a riot in the temple. So you know how when it talks about the money changers turning over in the Bible? There's a section in the Bible that talks about that I went through the whole temple tipping over everybody's tables that they had money on and animals on. What used to happen is they used to have all of these animals in the temple itself, like a slaughter yard, really it was, that people would have to buy because they were consecrated, and so they'd charge 10 times the amount that they'd normally charge for that animal, and the person would have to buy that animal, and then they'd slaughter the animal as a sacrifice for their sins, and the priesthood would get the animal and eat the animal. So it was also part of how the priests survived, right? So the temple was just like in the courtyard, just totally covered with animals, and it stunk like a slaughter yard, really. It was just terrible, and I often made comments about it when I went to Jerusalem. And this particular time I made a comment about how everybody was buying things at 10 times the price that they needed to, you know, and that wasn't, you know, that was so unfair. And I just, all I did was say that I stopped everybody first and then said it, and it just triggered some things in everybody, and everybody went nuts. Like, they all just felt all of that injustice all in that instant, and then there was just a riot in the temple. So they went through tipping over all of the money, stealing the money from the people who were selling, and all sorts of things went on. And of course the priests were highly concerned because they felt that I'd begun it. I wasn't involved in it myself, so I didn't actually do any of the things described in the Bible. All I did was just say the words. Anyway, that caused a big uproar. And so the next few days I was in the temple, I'd get lots of criticism from the priests. And then behind the scenes, there's also my disciples trying to organise these conflicts, if you like, between myself and the priesthood. And so no matter what I did to act lovingly, many of the people who were following me were trying to stir up even more trouble. So I'd try to address it with them, but they wouldn't listen either, because they wanted me to be the king and so forth. And it got out of hand, basically. And so by the day of that I was captured, I was hiding out, actually, in the Garden of Gethsemane. And I'd asked some of my friends to just keep a watch out for me, so that I could leave in time. But I also was praying a lot about the fact that nobody seemed to be getting the truth. Even my own disciples, the people who were following me, weren't getting the truth either. And I was praying a lot to God about that, about how I could prove the truth to them, rather than just speak the words and they not get the truth at all. And I could feel that things were just coming up to a boiling point, really. And so eventually Judas, and if it wasn't Judas, it would have been one of the others, organized for the Sanhedrin to actually come and capture me. And they wanted me out of the way by this stage. They'd already had two attempts on my life previously that were done with an assassin, but both of them failed. And so this time they wanted to make sure of it. So they actually arranged Judas to come up and show them who exactly I was in the dark, because it was dark. So that's how I was captured. And he thought that I would fight. He thought that I'd encourage the disciples to fight. So he thought that the way he thought was that he was encouraging an uprising, that I would then eventually take my full control as the leader and everything would be fine. That's how he thought. He didn't realise that no matter how much I said to him the opposite, he didn't realise that wasn't going to be what I would do. And he was just so shocked when I responded passively. And that's what eventually caused his suicide. He was just so shocked at my own response. Because he was a very good friend of mine as well, and still is, actually, a very good friend of mine. He's in the celestial spheres now. Then there was a big, basically similar to what the Bible describes, I went back and forward between Herod and Pilate, and eventually got into the hands of this man. Mm. And basically, Mel Gibson's The Passion, who's seen that? Most of you have seen that. Most of what's described in there is fairly accurate.
And I suppose the question you're asking, I think there was no healing, but my job was to nail him to a stake, which wasn't a cross. It's like a pole sort of thing. And so nailing him, had a spike, and just nailing the mallet into his hands and saw his eyes, and just looking at me just full of love, and that was just enough. I had enough then. Just so much stuff was stirring up. And just threw the mallet down, just walked off, which pretty much gave myself a death sentence too from the Roman army. Just entered, you're dead. And I don't know what happened in that scene after I just walked off and Went into sort of hiding. There's someone, I haven't figured any of this stuff out because I've got this feeling, but I haven't got onto anything, so I haven't got the emotional side of it. And it's coming up soon, I can feel it. But there was a woman I know, I knew. I don't know the connection with her though, like what she was to me. Someone close, which is unusual. And she hid me for 2 weeks until they found, I had a friend, used to be a good friend of mine in, as a soldier, his name was F.A.L. And but earlier on, we used to fight together and be quite like close to each other. We both went through the same experiences as a kid in the same way, and we grew quite a bond. You have to love someone sort of thing. You had a good friend and you had to share something out of yourself. And this is way back. And but they could sort of, we had to keep it kind of quiet, like we might just sort of like nod to each other sort of thing, let you know you're okay, mate, sort of thing. Or, but then they started picking up and all that sort of stuff, and they just would not have any of that, any sort of niceness didn't happen, so they separated us, went to different sort of legions and stuff like that. And but I think they set up stories, you know, to try and pit us against each other, to create hate back in us again. Like they've pitted words, and we could never never find out if it was true or not. About if that person said that against you, sort of thing, or they'd done something and put you in, like, got some punishment for that, like, hadn't done anything. And so this hate grew between us, or slowly, and you could never find out what the truth was. But because there's already hate within us, it's pretty easy to, like, trigger it. So back to my last 2 weeks of my life. I think I have a funny feeling he'd, like, dobbed me in where I was, sort of thing. And they come and found me, soldiers, and he led me away. There's crowds of people. It's being such a big person, and everybody in that time just feels so powerless. Everybody want to have a piece of me, basically. Just everybody. And I just would not give in, wouldn't just kept fighting and fighting and fighting. I was taken to an open public area and just beaten and beaten and beaten and beaten. I think I had my back broken because I can't remember any feeling in my legs. And they speared me to the ground, threw my shoulder. I speared to the ground and had fingers cut off, tips cut off. They actually ripped open my stomach and starting to get all intestines spilling out, sort of thing. I just lay there for 4 days until I eventually died. But I remember last thing I saw, the last thing I remember in my body too, was my breath. That's all I had. That told me I was still alive. And I could just hear the last breath, was it gone? But I remember the saddest, or sad for me, because the last thing I saw was my mother's eyes in the crowd. You could just see her, like, down low between her legs, just looking, and just see the love still that was there. So from the start of my life to the end, the rest of my term was just a lot of bullshit. Love was actually real. It took that long to find it out. And I just thought it was all fake, just a lie. That's all the stuff that happened to me, told me it was. I just believed everything that happened. And the same thing too, when I passed in the spirit world, after hearing what Jesus was talking about to everybody, had this belief that you go to a place, a heaven, and it was just another load of crap. We got to some place that was really horrible, just full of darkness and just cold, and there's no one around. I think I didn't want anybody around. And just in a heap for about, I think it was roughly 70 years or something, just lying on the ground curled up, and just didn't want to be around anybody, just hated everybody, hated the world. Just went to a place because of things I'd done that were quite, it's not a very nice place. And it took that long. It took so long until I eventually wanted to face some of the stuff. And I remember somebody coming up, I'm not sure who it was, I think it was a guide that I had during my whole life. And they just come down to help me up, just took my hand and just sat up on my knees and just wanted to listen at last. Just surrendered after fighting, and I was still fighting in the spirit world. Just fighting against everything I felt, fighting against all the things that happened, not letting it come in emotionally. When that time changed or I wanted to feel it, that's when things started to move again.
So I watched Corny getting tortured from the spirit world. And it was a really horrific death that he had.
It was made as an example for any others to dissent the Roman army, any others that want to, any population, people that want to have a fight against them. It was showing a force, just letting everybody know they're under control. Mm.
And he basically, what's the word when you get out of an army without getting approval to get out
dissent,
of
the army? Dissent, is it?
Absent without leave.
AWOL.
No, there's another word.
Deserter,
yeah. So he was treated as a deserter. Yeah.
So, really, the experience of Cornelius should give us a lot of hope, because he went into the hells,
yeah,
and he progressed to the 22nd sphere,
yeah,
to allow him to combine and come back here. So, I guess we all, you know, treat you, I know you say you're ordinary, but he's still special to us.
Yeah.
Whereas Cornelius is a stranger to most of us, I guess.
Yeah.
And it's just a wonderful feeling that listening to, you know, your early history, it gives me a lot of hope.
Well, it is for everybody, because there's so many people who have had horrible lives and stuff, and but a lot of that stuff, you know, when you've... Well, in my life, there was love at the start, and there was actually love was real at the end. That's what I found out. That's right at the end, and just all that crap in between was nothing I could enjoy because I didn't know the truth.
But he passed into the hells because of all of the terrible things that he'd done in his life, and had to work through all of those things emotionally, and he was the I think his soul pair was the fourth soul pair to enter the 22nd sphere state. So after coming from that kind of a background on the earth, being the fourth soul pair to enter the 22nd sphere state, you can see his strong desire for love, you know, once he connected with all of that. And that's a very unique experience. Of all the 14 that have returned, Cornelius has probably had one of the most unique experiences of all the 14 who have returned, in the sense that of all the 14 who have returned, many of the 14 entered the hills when they passed, but only for very brief periods of time. And so his experience is probably, he had the worst experience in the hills that all of the 14 have experienced.
Just out of that. Yeah, what understanding do you have of the BC and the AD, like of the 33 years that
I actually lived 35 years, but everyone thinks I lived 33. As for BC and AD, they basically just calculated when they felt I must have been born. It was a bit out, actually. I was born in 5 BC. So.
Just, when it says like BC and then it goes AD, it's got no explanation of the 35 years at all.
No.
If you can understand what I mean. Yeah. I was hoping you had some sort of explanation about that.
No, I don't know why the historians chose to do what they did. I know they based it around my existence on Earth and when I was meant to have been born, but as to why they've miscalculated my birth, it was due to different spirit channeling that was coming through, and if they channeled some information, they would have got the timing right. But unfortunately, what's happened is that they've tried to come up with intellectual arguments about when I must have been born. And so, you know, that makes it a bit more difficult for them to understand the truth, yeah.
Corny, is your soulmate here on Earth? I
guess so, but I never met my soulmate in the first century. It wasn't probably till, I think it's roughly the fifth sphere that I met her. I have no idea who she is at the moment. And with my injuries, I don't even want to go near it. I need to still deal with some wound issues and some men issues and some lot issues and all that sort of stuff. Yeah, just don't think it'd be very productive right now for her if I met her.
I have a feeling of who she is, but Corny doesn't want to know.
Can you remember much of your progression in the spirit world?
Not really. I haven't really had many memories. I I'm going through a lot of the heavy sort of stuff at the moment, a lot of the niceties at the moment, so yeah. So not only that, only the moment's really in the hells, more so. I've been trying to work out all my dreams, like, haven't worked them out exactly. All my dreams are in darkness, like twilighting. Those for years, I still don't really understand those either. It's sort of a little bit like that. The spirit world is really quite dark, really dark, and just desolate, alone, because that's what feelings I had inside myself about the whole everything. That's all.
Corny's had a lot of spirits. He's been near people who are mediumistic quite a lot of his life, but particularly recently. And so he's had a lot of experiences of first century people who have been harmed by his life, who are still in the hells, coming to him to talk to him about that, or more often than not to project anger at him about that. So he's having to work through many of his experiences he's working through by this interaction of what's going on between himself in this state now and people who were in the first century who he harmed. So it's quite confronting.
I feel really confused because, he's gone to 27 level. Why he still has stuff to do?
I've answered all of those questions in a writing that I've written, and it's on the CD. It's called Reincarnation and Divine Love. All of those questions are answered in there. My suggestion is to have a read of that document. It'll explain what happens when you reincarnate. And what happens, and I've said this quite a number of times, but most people don't seem to get it, but what happens is that when you reincarnate, all of your memories, which don't have emotional attachments to them anymore, so in the 22nd sphere state, you remember every event of your life, but there's no emotion with it. Does that make sense? So you remember all the bad things you've done still, but there's no emotional connection with those things. When you reincarnate, all of those memories get filtered now through the parent's emotional condition, right? So you get basically reinfected with emotion from your parent's condition with those memories. And with all of the 14, there's 7 types of memories that we have to deal with. There's the memories that we had in the first century. There's the memories that we had in the spirit world. There's the memories that we get from the reincarnation process and in this life. Then there's also, when you're in the 22nd sphere state, you can swap memories with your soulmate. So some of the 14 have taken their soulmate's memories as well. So you've got your soulmate's experience in the first century, the soulmate experience in the spirit world, and the soulmate experience in the reincarnation state. And you've got all of these emotions to work through. So we've got 6 or 7 times the amounts of emotions that you would have to work through. Then if you multiply that by 2,000 years of life, that'll give you an idea of how much emotion the all of the 14 have to deal with. So it's quite a lot. And so that's why it takes a lot of really strong dedication on the part of someone who's one of the 14 to actually work through their emotions. And it also takes a long time to work through those emotions, obviously. So it's really important to understand, well, it's not really important for you, it's really important that the 14 understand that when they're working through their emotional condition. Yeah.
With the parental emotions that we pick up when we come through, how far back do they go? Is that sort of back into eons of time?
Generational, yeah. So it goes back. So great-grandparents, parents, and so forth, all the way through, all have an emotional impact on you of all of their unresolved emotion.
And it's unimportant where it came from.
It's just important to let it go so you don't infect the next generation.
The buck stops here.
Yeah.
What was the, in your life as Jesus, what was the clearing that you spoke of that happened after you you said that that's sort of what made it different for you? Was it celestial spirits that came and what clear your parents?
There was no celestial spirits in the first century when I was born. There was no 7th sphere or 8th sphere. None of the spheres above the 6th were created when I was born. There were some natural love spirits who were assigned to guide me, who helped through some of those processes. So helped me deal with emotion and release emotion right at the time of birth. Yeah.
At the time of birth?
Yeah. And that was a decision made by God to them and then to myself. And as I still don't have too many memories associated with that, because I'm still having an issue with fully taking up the truth is actually that every sphere above the sixth I created. And it's pretty hard for me at the moment in my emotional condition to come to terms with that emotionally. And so I struggle a lot with that still. I'm still having a lot of struggle emotionally, just dealing with that and dealing with the fact that I was the first one into every one of those spheres, and there's a lot of emotions associated with that I have now. So it's difficult for me to... Anything that's to do with me and God's interaction with me at the moment is difficult for me to accept. And I'm still working through emotions about that. In fact, that's the group of emotions that I'm working through now. Yeah.
Part of that question, I think you said in the past that your parents attracted a child like you. What would have been their emotion attracted a child like you?
My father had a really deep passion for the Messiah, and so did my mother. They both had very strong feelings that the Messiah would come in their generation, and they had really strong emotions about that, about them wanting to be a part of whatever would happen. So they had some really strong emotions about that happened through their life because of their education and because of their emotional state. And so by the time, like, I was attracted to their life because of their strong longing for that to occur. My feelings are the Messiah could have ended up being someone else. That's not what I'm getting told from my spirit friends. So me and my spirit friends have some disagreement about this issue. And it's because of the emotions that I'm struggling to face about the issue. I do know that inside of me, I've just had this strong longing for truth above everything else, and also a strong longing for God above everything else. And those two longings, I suppose you could say at the soul level, I just desire that more than anything. And so that passion created my getting in the condition to be the first person to enter this at-one-ment state with God. And obviously once you enter the at-one-ment state with God, then God can channel truth through you, which then assists everyone else around you to become into that same condition. As to why God selected me and all of those kind of things, or whether I selected myself in the sense of my passions and longings selected me, I'm still out on those. The jury's still out on those issues for me emotionally. I know what I'm being told, but I don't always agree with it here, you know. So there's still a lot of things for me to accept emotionally about those things.
I would like to understand about the role of women, particularly women being subjugated and in the first century, and perhaps even from Eve down, and understand why it's called history, his story, and there's no her story.
I would like to answer a lot of those questions perhaps another time, because you could almost spend an entire afternoon on those questions alone, and in fact more. I would like to actually spend a lot more time than that on those questions. Just briefly though, in the first century, one of the first things I noticed was how women were being treated, and so in terms of my own treatment, to become at one with God, you need to treat everybody impartially, which means that if you're a male, you need to treat men and women identically, without partiality. And I realised that quite early on in my own progression, that would be the case. And so I spent a lot of time in the first century trying to address issues with women, which is the reason why more of the followers were women than men. But unfortunately, many of the men followers still had a lot of the emotions against women that they retained after my passing. And so they became very dominant. I actually wanted Mary Magdalene to sort of be the person who led the progression. She was the most developed person on earth, aside from myself when I die. But none of the male disciples would have a bar of that. And so things pretty rapidly degraded for women, even in the Christian movement, because of that. In terms of why it happened from Adam and Eve stage, well, I can answer that at a different time. There are very good reasons. When I say very good reasons, they're not justifiable, but there's reasons why that happens. When you walk away from God, what actually happens inside of you as a male, and what happens inside of you as a female, and how those interactions occur, and what actually happens. That I could spend a lot of hours describing that to you, but it's not. I thought with this opportunity with Corny being over, that we could ask more questions surrounding our lives.
Yeah. Can you talk about the transfiguration on the cross, on the stake? What was happening for you emotionally?
The transfiguration was an event that happened 3.5 years before I died. And what happened there was that I had three disciples with me, John, Peter and James, and those three came up to a mountain with me, and for the first time two spirits had entered the celestial sphere state. This was after I'd entered the celestial sphere state. Moses and Elisha had entered the celestial sphere state. And what the transfiguration was about was to display to people on earth, but also to people in the spirit world, that this new spiritual condition was available to them, of divine love entering the soul to abundance with God. And so Moses and Elisha displayed as spirits what it was meant to be at one with God, and I displayed as a person on earth what it meant to be at one with God. Which is the reason why all of our bodies all brightened up and we displayed our normal condition in that state. So when you're in a normal state spiritually, you detune your state to suit the surroundings. But once you're in a one-minute state with God, you can actually have all of the energy from God passing through you and actually show that to everyone around you as well. And I did that just to three of the disciples, but the two spirits, Moses and Elisha, did it to the spirit world, demonstrating that condition.
So when you were on the stake and people were looking at you, in the, how it says in the Bible, that was happening then, and people...
It wasn't happening then. Okay. Yeah, no, that was anybody looking at me on the stake would have just thought that I'm a normal person. Aside from, as Corny noticed, the amount of love that I was coming out of my feelings, they would have just felt me to be a normal person to look at, who was dying on a stake.
And what was happening for you emotionally? Like, did you still feel the connection and that this was evolving as it needed to?
Yeah. Yep. Well, when you're in an at-one-ment condition, God's love doesn't leave you for any event, as long as you just keep staying open to your emotional condition. And so, the entire time I was on the stake, and the time I was tortured before then as well, I could maintain that connection with God. But I felt a lot of physical pain, but it was nowhere near the pain that a normal person would have felt in that particular situation. So this is what sort of is a bit strange for me when people glorify the crucifixion, because in the end, like, you know how a lot of Christians say, oh, he had a terrible death, and actually my death, of all of the 14 who have returned, my death was probably the easiest. In terms of dealing with it emotionally now, it's probably one of the hardest, I've had probably the hardest experiences, but because I've had the torture events of my soulmate to deal with as well. That's one of the memories I brought back with me. I've had her rape and abusive issues inside of me as well to deal with, as well as some torture events that happened when I was 20 years of age, and also 17, 20, and also when I died. So there's been quite a lot of emotion within me to deal with about torture and rape and abuse and all of those kind of things. So in terms of dealing with it now, my emotion's difficult, but in terms of the experience itself then, it was probably one of the easiest experiences compared to what the others have, because they were not in an at-one-ment condition with God when they passed. Far from it, yeah.
In the Bible it says that you died for the sins of the world. Is that correct?
No.
No. And that the sky came over black and you said, "My God, why
have you forsaken me?" No, I didn't say that either. No.
So what was
I feel like that now, though. It's interesting that many of these things I've meant to have said then, I've had feelings to process about now, but the truth is I didn't say that then. I didn't feel like God had forsaken me. There was a storm that day, but it wasn't because of any supernatural event. And I certainly didn't die for anyone's sins, because every single sin you create, you will have to pay for. Have any of you seen that? I'll just answer the question though. The truth is that what happened shortly after my passing is that many of the people who were following up afterwards couldn't understand how I'd gotten into it in a one-minute condition. Does that make sense? So what they did was they decided to come up with different theories and philosophies about that. And they made me God's son, but God the son. And then they made me this person who pays for everybody's sins. And what happened was a very Pauline, when I say Pauline, the Apostle Paul, who wrote 13 different books of the Bible, came up with a lot of theories that linked early Jewish teachings with Christianity. And the early Jewish teachings were all about sacrifice for sins, blood being spilled for a sin. And so what he did was he linked that up with my blood being spilled for the sins of the world. None of that's true, of course, because if it was true, there'd be no one in the hills at all, because everyone would have already have paid all those sins. So none of that is true, but...
From that moment in history, everybody just be...
Yeah.
Yes. I've never seen anything that document that.
Yeah.
It was obvious.
Christians say logical. That, you know, unless you actually believe in Jesus, you know, you can't go to heaven. Right?
Well, there is a truth in some of this, unfortunately, for all of you to hear this. There is a truth that you'll recognise in the sixth or seventh sphere of your own progression, where you'll realise that God has the right to choose his messenger, of who his messenger of truth is going to be. And if you recognize that messenger of truth yourself and listen to the truths that that messenger of truth gives you, then obviously your own salvation works out. If you decide to not listen to that messenger of truth, then you will never enter the eighth sphere. So that is a truth. But it's not I paying for anyone's sins. It's just that the truths that my Father has given me and which my Father will give you as you enter these, you know, into these new emotional states, mean that there was obviously someone who got to that state first, and that person has helped the rest of humanity get into that state as well. So, you know, from that perspective, that's why in the first century I called myself the Way, the Truth and the Life, and that hasn't changed. So at some point, I know many of you have a real struggle understanding sometimes what I'm talking about and understanding what I mean when I say I'm Jesus. And I am the person Jesus, not a reincarnation of Jesus or any of those things. I am reincarnated, obviously, but I am the soul. The soul hasn't changed. And once you understand, too, that, you know, if you listen to these truths, that you will progress the most rapidly you can progress, and you will progress into this at-one-ment state, then you'll realise, of course, at that time, that obviously there's a lot of blessings that come from your choice to listen. And many of you will go through this state at the moment of, do I listen to him? Oh, you know, sometimes he's a bit crazy and he's still got these emotions. How can I believe that? And all those kind of things. And in time, all of those things will iron out. You'll be able to work through those things if you work through them emotionally. So that's the main thing to bear in mind with all of these, things.
Can you talk about what happens when you don't listen?
Well, when you don't listen, what happens is you will stagnate at a certain condition. So let's say you listen a bit and you say, oh, well, I can trust AJ with these things because that sounds right to me. You'll find you'll progress to a certain spiritual condition, but then you won't progress further until you can accept those other truths. And that's what just happens with everyone. And I know it's hard. In the end, you're not listening to me. You're choosing to listen to God. But the things that I'm teaching you are how to listen to God, how to actually do these things, how to progress in this way. Somebody over here. Yeah.
I just want to know how you feel when it comes to Easter and Christmas.
I'm very uncomfortable. I don't celebrate both of those celebrations myself. And usually those times, I'm usually alone. Even in the spirit world, I was alone during those times. I get a lot of projected emotion from people on earth and in the spirit world who don't understand the truth during those times. And I find it very, very difficult to cope with because of the untruth that's connected with it all. And so while I'm not saying to you, don't celebrate Easter or Christmas, that's up to you what you do. As long as you understand that I've got nothing, it doesn't really involve me, right? I know everyone thinks it does, but my feelings about it are I would rather there be other celebrations. Like, I would love to see a celebration of God's, like when I first got divine love to the point of atonement, like just that celebration of that time would be a lovely time to celebrate, that I could feel I could celebrate in good conscience. But
what would be the date?
Ironically, it's very close to my birth date now, the date that I, which is March the 10th.
So when exactly was that in your lifetime?
I was 31. And I knew I was getting close for some time. I was in the seventh sphere for some time, nearly 6 years of my progression I spent in the seventh sphere. But the seventh sphere is a really difficult condition on earth to work your way through because there is so much projected emotion that you're very sensitive to feeling. And it's very difficult. There's also some very fine truths to learn as well in that condition. And so it often takes quite some time to get through the seventh sphere when you're on earth. In the seventh sphere on the spirit world, it's a bit easier because everyone around you is in the seventh sphere. And so it's very much easier in the seventh sphere to work way through the issues that come up in terms of truths. And also because everybody now knows them in the seventh sphere, of course, you get told them one after the other after the other as fast as you can cope with them emotionally. So, I spent around 6 years in the seventh sphere on the earth in the first century and then entered the point of atonement with God just before my baptism. And my baptism with John the Baptist was my celebration, if you like, of that time.
So that was after that, okay.
Yeah. So when I was baptized by John, that was just before then. About a month before then, I'd entered that condition, and I walked down to where John was. He was a friend of mine, and I walked down to him and I discussed with him what had actually happened, and we talked about our plans now that we'd made over the years before, about him being the person who would go into a town first and prepare the town, and then I'd follow in, and so forth. And so we talked about a lot of those plans, and I just felt like it would be nice to have a bit of a sort of a ritual, I suppose, which was my personal ritual. I'm sometimes regretful that I did it now, because now, you know, babies are being baptized and all sorts of things, and they don't understand why I did it. But at the time, I did it because it was my personal ritual of you know, just marking the occasion, if you like.
How did you meet Mary in the first century?
I knew about her for quite some time because I knew the family, knew her brother and her sister, and her brother and sister weren't always warm with me because they were quite confronted by my confrontation of the Jewish system of things, particularly the Pharisaical system. And so they weren't always feelings of warmth there, but they lived in a town called Bethany, which was near Jerusalem. But when Mary had a terrible upbringing in life, and she was abused, sexually abused as a child in the first century, and she's still feel a lot of things about that. I took most of those memories, so I'm still feeling a bit of those things myself. Then she was raped a number of times before she was 14. She was a very pretty girl, and a lot of boys in the town that she grew up in finished up picking on her in that way and raping her and things like that. And in the end, her family sort of treated her like she was damaged goods and she would never be married. So what they did is they sent her away. And she eventually made it. She followed the Jordan. She had some very lonely times and terrible times, and she followed the Jordan, getting hurt and by men mostly all the way up, and she eventually found a group of women who had been hurt by men in the town of Magdala, and that's where she resided. She eventually became quite a good and I don't want to say too much about her life actually at this point. In fact, I won't say too much about her life at this point because it's important that she works through a lot of these emotions and tells you herself. But I will say how I met her. I was shortly after I'd begun my ministry. I went to Magdala, and we were greeted out the front of the town, because by then it was known that I had healed some people in other towns, and we were greeted in front of town by a group of women that she had organised to greet us. And they looked after us in terms of, you know, meals and all those kind of things. By this stage, she had quite a lot of money because she'd had a benefactor who she was living with die, and he provided lots of money. He loved her and provided lots of money to her, so she had lots of money to spend on things like that. So she actually had, by this stage, organised for these women who were harmed to be looked after, and they all greeted us. And that's where I met her, yeah. So I knew straight away she was my soulmate. She didn't know I was.
And you took, in the 22nd sphere, you took some of Mary's traumas on to ease her burden in this life.
Yeah, because my life in the first century was much easier than hers in a lot of ways. Particularly because of the condition I was in, more than anything. It wasn't easier in terms of the life, but it was easier in terms of the condition I was in. So, you know, for yourselves at the moment, it's your emotional response to what happens in your life that determines how happy you are, right? Mm-hmm. So if you have all of these different emotions within you, you know, of trauma and all these things happening inside of you, then obviously when a certain event happens, it can be very traumatic. And yet if that same event happens for another person, they can hardly even notice it, right? Now, in the first century, that's what my life was like. There were some traumatic events that happened to me, but in the sense of how I reacted to them, there was far less reaction than I would have now, even. For Mary, it was totally the opposite. She had a terribly traumatic life all the way through her life. And even after I left, she had a terribly traumatic life. And so, in the 22nd sphere state, we chose to separate the memories in a way that I could deal with a lot of those emotions. And it wasn't a point of so much of self-sacrifice, it was to do with me wanting to understand her experience coming from a condition of sin. Does that make sense? Mm. So I chose to take in all of, pretty much most of the emotions of the childhood abuse, all of those emotions, and all of the rape-based emotions up until the age of 14. And there were also some traumatic events that I'm still working my way through now, about her death that I took as well. So, but she's still got a fair bit on her plate. So. It's made it more confusing for both of us, actually. Mary, for me, it's made it more confusing for me because there was, at one time, I couldn't understand how all of these sexual abuse emotions had come about, for example. And it took a lot of getting rid of my mind in the process to actually deal with them. And then once I dealt with them, I had the memories of what was actually happening. So it was really, really quite a struggle for me to deal with those emotions. And for Mary, it's quite a struggle too now because, you know, there's a lot of those emotions which will point out to her who she is that she hasn't had. So that makes it a struggle for her too. But it was going to be a struggle either way. So the way it's happened, it's been very educational for me in terms of my own experience now. But for Mary, you'll have to ask her another time. Yeah.
In your first century life, where are all of us? I have a difficulty coming to terms with a recognition of Cornelius and a recognition of you. And I'm wondering, is that a matter of being open to truth here and now, or where are all of us when you're living? Do you understand what my question is?
I think so, Jenny. I think you're really asking, like, many of you have had pictures enter your minds about first century, about being you know, some of the events that may have happened to myself and other people that you may have met around that time. Many of you may have had feelings that you were actually there in the first century because of that. And what's happened is that there are billions of celestial spirits now. And all of those celestial spirits know the truth about what's happened in our lives. And what they've done is that they've given you pictures and feelings and emotions for two different reasons. One is so that you can firstly connect to your own emotions and deal with those emotions. But the second one is so that you can recognize what things are linked to the divine truth. Right? So, and all of the events in the first century are very much linked to the divine truth and the first time the divine truth became known on earth. And so it's important that these kind of pictures also enter you, and you'll receive them feeling like you're there, right? And in fact, none of the 14 have that. None of the 14 have that. So all we have is we have to do with our emotion, and then the pictures come. We don't get pictures like that. And any time you get pictures like that from any source, it's a spirit giving you those pictures, right? Because the way your emotions get processed about your own memories is that you've got to have the emotional experience first before you'll generally remember things, or you'll get pictures in your dream state or your sleep state given to you either by yourself or by somebody else. That's how you deal with your own stuff. And we deal with our own stuff exactly the same way because we're just the same as you. When you receive pictures and everything like in your mind like you're actually there, that's actually a spirit giving you those pictures, telling you what's going on and linking you with what the divine truth is all about. So some of you have had experiences in your life where you've never really believed in Jesus or never really believed that there was anything important about all that, but then had some pictures happen in your own minds and then realised there's got to be something there that I've got to look at. Does that make sense? Mm. And that is actually your spirit guides guiding that process, giving you those pictures to bring you to an awareness of where the divine truth began.
What's the most empowering way to relate to spirits in the celestial spheres? Or should we even want to do that? Or
can we answer those questions another time?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we'll just focus on the life stuff here today while we've got the opportunity.
To both of you, what was your favourite meal in the first century?
century. Favourite male?
Meal.
Favourite meal, Corey?
Vegetable and fruit.
I have no idea. Food's not important, sort of thing. It's just all feeling stuff, really. It's just insignificant. It's just something sort of like feeds the human body so it can keep moving. So it's not important. Whatever you can get, sort of thing.
Mine, I have some favourites. Mine are all fruit. So any fruit, I would.
First century,
yeah. Yeah. Any fruit, that was me. I was in.
What's a dried fruit?
Sorry?
Dried fruit?
No, fresh.
Oh.
Fresh, yeah. No, I was vegetarian. I was vegan in the first century, yeah.
Is that what they chuck tomatoes at
No, back then you didn't waste food very much, so you didn't get food chucked at you very often. If food got thrown at you, you were in a pretty bad place. Well, you were in a pretty bad place. It meant they were pretty angry.
Just your rocks.
To get rid of their food. Yeah.
I went to Israel back in 2005 and I met a nun there, and she was convinced that the Last Supper occurred in the room under her church,
yep.
Or the church that she was at. And I always see the pictures of the Last Supper being this vast room with a huge table. But when we actually entered this room underneath, it was actually really quite small. It was, probably wouldn't have been anywhere near the amount of room there that where one of those tables would have fitted.
Yeah, the Last Supper thing is a very... can you imagine, like, I'm just getting together with my mates, having a meal, and there's women there too, obviously, like, the men and women are all there. My soulmate's there. We're just getting together having a meal, right, in somebody's house. That's all that happened. And I had some feelings about Judas's actions, you know, that he was being duplicitous with me. But I didn't say much about that. I noticed he left partway through the meal. But honestly, when there's 20 or 30 people in a room, you don't notice who comes and goes and where they might be going, do you? Like, you know, you don't. They could be going to the toilet for all you know, right? And although I knew that he was probably going somewhere else, I didn't say much about it, and I didn't think too much about it either. I was just enjoying a lot of times with my friends, really. That's all I was doing. We were in a hiding because it was a little, things were a little topsy-turvy, shall we say, with regard to the Jewish Sanhedrin's response to my being in Jerusalem at the time. But it was a small, smallish room. There was no great big single table where we all sat around. The way, you know, usually what we did was sat on the floor, or usually the way that a room was organised for a meal was you would just lay on sort of divans all the way around and eat. So it was just a normal meal. And it's been made into this, you know, and certainly some of the apostles and disciples there drank wine. I didn't stop anybody else from drinking wine. I didn't drink it. But I didn't pass a cup around and say, this is my blood, you know, and pass some bread around and do all that. None of that. I knew that it was fairly close to my death, and so I was really appreciating the time that I could spend with everyone. And there were lots of lessons that I was trying to teach during that time as well, particularly of humility, because many of them had problems with humility. So I was trying to teach a lot of those lessons, and I took the opportunity at that time to teach some lessons as well. But my soulmate was there, along with many other women too. So it wasn't just all men or anything like that.
The whole area there, and even the walk down to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Mm-hmm. Was that the actual site? Are you saying that's the actual site as well?
I haven't been to Jerusalem since, so I can't tell you. When I go, I'll know where it is and where the sites are, but I haven't actually been there.
It's meant to have been like the real Stations of the Cross. That's supposed to have been the main one.
Yeah. You know, I can remember it as it was then in my pictures, like as it was 2,000 years ago. Obviously, it's very different now. I'll have it when I go there. I have some feelings about everything, about where everything occurred. But at some point in the future, I think I would like to go for that reason. But I I can more just feel the pictures in my own mind about what happened 2,000 years ago than actually where it is now, if that makes sense. Yeah.
Just a question for Cornelius. When you came through in this life, like, were you a little bit sort of bitter and twisted while you were growing up and just didn't know why? Did you carry through some of that anger and that without actually realising what it was
coming to this life? I just could say I was shit scared the whole time, just being scared as a kid. I was scared of everything, scared of people, just untrusting, really afraid of my parents ever, like, if you had to have had to move anywhere, afraid of just like change. I just wanted like security more so, I suppose. Afraid of going to different states, even like out of my comfort zone sort of thing. That's about it, really. Have dreams of being going down like a tunnel sort of thing all the time. I get really, really scared. Never get to the bottom of it. I don't know if that's birth or not. I haven't worked that out yet. I'm just scared. Mm-hmm. But I know, do you mean like my parents' emotions and stuff when you come in? Or
I was just from memories. Because obviously you were saying that you were pretty bitter and twisted in the first life. And I just was curious how much of that you brought through without realising. I mean, obviously now you're working through that. And you sort of recognise where it's coming from, but...
Yeah, it depends on my parents' emotions, though, too, when I come in. Imagine if I had a quite violent father, had lots of raging and bad anger, that'd bring up all those... to energise all those memories, basically. Yeah, so a lot of those haven't... Dad's not like that at all. He's quite a very loving man. Yeah, so it's been quite good in that way. Actually, a lot of the thing that touches me most, or the most emotional thing that sort of triggers me, is just kindness. If anybody's kind to me, just like... just blows me away to start crying straight away. Once I let it sink in, I don't often let that sink in though. Just never ever had that in not last time. So because all those memories are coming up, that's coming on more and more. Actually now, in this life, I've always wondered why I was never really close to my family. Like, I am, like, but I'm not, sort of thing. You know, they're always loving, they're great people and everything, but I don't have a feeling to be around them. I actually have a feeling to be, they're in Melbourne, I'm in Western Australia. Can't get much further, and but that wasn't a choice I made intellectually or anything. Just always wondered. I felt kind of bad, and growing up at school, and people would tell you about their parents are divorced, and I sort of felt unappreciative because I had really good parents and upbringing and stuff like that. Yet I didn't appreciate it. Didn't feel like, and I felt bad for not appreciating it, but I could never understand why. Whereas they didn't have it and they wanted it, but I thought, geez, I'm a selfish bastard or something like that, or. I just couldn't work out why.
Do either of you look similar facially now to how you looked in the first century?
My partner, she's kind of mediumistic. And she's, like, sometimes I have conversations just about general day stuff, and she's kind of looking at me funny, and she explains sometimes you can see my features and she wishes you could paint or draw. And I had green eyes back then, she said, to really, really bright green. It's more sort of, I can kind of picture something, but I don't know if it's me. It's kind of weird. A bit more thicker in the sort of round here. Can't remember, she said something about my nose too. I always feel about this jaw part, something's familiar about that. Just sort of blacky, wavy sort of hair, probably around there sort of thing. Yeah, that's all I kind of figure or feel. And yourself?
In terms of facial features, fairly similar. In terms of body, a fair bit different, but facial features, fairly similar. Yeah.
Did you have darker skin or?
No, actually, I had about the same colouring as I have now, and a bit lighter hair in the first century than I had now. And I had bluey, purpley eyes in the first century, rather than brown eyes that I'm commonly depicted as having. So just a bit different, but in terms of the sort of facial features and my prominent nose and all that stuff, that's all pretty much the same.
There's one thing I must ask you. When people pray to Jesus today, can you feel it?
A lot of times when people are praying for Jesus with their words, their feelings are actually that they want a connection with God. So remember that it's the feelings that connect you with a person. or with God. So if they're praying to Jesus with the words, but actually having a feeling they want to connect with God, then often, you know, they're connecting directly with God. When people are praying to me, they're often praying to me because they don't connect with God. They feel they can't connect with God, and they feel a bit more rapport with me rather than with God. And so generally, yes, I do try and respond to that. In the spirit world, I also responded to that as much as I could. But obviously, when you've got hundreds of thousands or even millions of people doing that at once, you can't respond to every person. So the person with the strongest desire generally was the person I'd respond to. Yeah.
So there's no analogy as around?
No, well, there's literally hundreds of thousands of people in the spirit world who respond to those prayers, saying they're Jesus. Yeah, so there's plenty of people who falsify that they are for lots of different reasons, because it gives them a feeling of power or importance, or it gives them a feeling of rapport with somebody on earth that they want, or yeah, and most of them are in the first sphere. They're in the first sphere or in the hills, responding, I find it really interesting sometimes. They, you know, people say, oh, but Jesus said to me such and such and such and such. And if you hear the words of what Jesus said, a lot of times it's actually very unloving what he said, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a good indication that you're not connecting to Jesus. You just think you are. And it's actually someone else you're talking to, another spirit. And that's happening all the time. There's literally hundreds of thousands of people in the spirit world who respond to a person on earth and claim they're Jesus so that they can have a rapport with the person on earth.
So when you leave here, when you decide to go back again, what happens then? You go back to the old Jesus?
No, remember my soul is who I am. So it is who I am. Where I will go will depend totally on what emotions that I've dealt with by the time I pass. So the Apostle John, for example, was murdered a year and a half ago. He was one of the 14 who returned. And he passed into the first sphere. He's now in the 19th sphere. But he passed into the first sphere because he still hadn't resolved a lot of his earth-based emotions. And so he still had to go through that process. Now, because he passed into the spirit world and remembered his life in the spirit world very rapidly, of course you start remembering all the lessons very rapidly as well, right? So you can progress very rapidly. But it just depends totally on what condition I am right now as to where I would pass. So I'm still governed by the laws of God just like you are. So if I've got an emotion in me, which I have right now, of like there's this feeling of I have a feeling of deep sort of resentment at the moment about me being in this position where I've got to be the focus of thousands of people for the message to happen. Like I personally want just a private life, you know, like all I've ever wanted this life is to go off bush somewhere with my girl and we just have a nice quiet life, bring up a family, you know, grow old together and pass. That's all I've ever wanted. So me having to do even a group like this is a huge confronting thing for me. And I realize I need to do it for a lot of reasons. One of them is this passion that I have to teach the truth. But obviously I've got very different emotions than what people assume I have. I'm finding more and more there's this really big picture thing, and I haven't spoken to any of you about the big picture events and the big picture things that are going to be happening, and I've purposely not done that, because in the end it's important just to get through the emotional work first, right?
Yeah.
But those big picture things are big emotions as well that I need to work my way through, and so like the Apostle John couldn't work his way through them before he passed because he couldn't accept them emotionally, and so he had to work through them after he passed. If you'd asked me 4 days ago, I would have said the next 20 years. No, it depends on every day as to what's going on. But I'm feeling like I'm right down at some really probably two or three core issues to go. One core issue that I have that I've that I've only really just become aware of is how much anger and rage I have within me. So that's a very core issue. Once I work through that, that might take a few months for me to do. That'll be a huge difference in me then. There's one or two other major issues, one with my soulmate that I need to work through, and one with God that I need to work through. And then there's these just little issues after that, like issues that are not very large and not sort of earth-shattering issues, but just emotions that I need to release. So I don't know, it might take another year or a couple of years, or I'm not really sure. The way I view it now is I'm just doing my best to do it as fast as I can. Just for my own happiness firstly, even. I think a few years probably things will be a little different for me, yeah.
I know you're not going to talk about what's happening in the future, but can you just give us an idea, because you know you're doing a lot of work at the moment with groups, and you're always quite busy, you know, during the weekends. Have we progressed at all?
Yeah. I don't know if you guys have felt it within yourselves, but you've had lots of progression. And a lot of you have had really lots of truths hitting you, one after the other, after the other, after the other, right? Many of you can feel that occurring. Many of you have also noticed now that your emotional life is getting a bit more tumultuous. You notice that? Well, that's the result of you working through issues now rather than just denying them. So that's big shifts. They're big shifts, right? All of these big shifts are really, really important for you. So just even being in a group like this where other people are just open to experiencing more truth causes a shift in yourself. And that's why it's so good to be in the group. I don't know if you've noticed, but sometimes when you watch the DVDs again, you notice you get more out of it each time.
Yeah.
You notice that, oh, I didn't realise that was said. Like, now I get that, you know, and I didn't really get it at the time. Well, that's an indication that you've actually grown and changed in this short period of time. So, yeah, all of you are growing and changing quite a lot. And I feel that in you a lot. You know, a lot of you are getting into these new states of emotional acceptance to truth. And new states of emotional acceptance of your own emotion that you weren't in before. And that's really good indication that you're getting in new states. Some of you are even starting to live in your passions a bit more, like focusing on living in your emotions and living in your passions a bit more. And that's a really good state to be in too. So yeah, there's been lots of progress actually. And probably more progress in the last year on Earth than I've noticed before. And the people in this area are leading the way a lot as well. And I think it's a lot of that's because all of you are so open to receiving, more open emotionally than many people in other locations. Yeah. The problem that you're going to face is that you'll get to a point at some point of anger and frustration. And many people, when they get to that point, then give up, you know, or they just blame me for upsetting their life or whatever is the easiest thing to do. And my suggestion is that's when it gets a bit difficult. That's when it gets more difficult. But there's lots and lots of tools that you can use to break through those conditions. And, you know, many therapists have lots and lots of different tools. You know, Grant has some, and there's, as a lady I've just visited yesterday who has some as well, who can help you break through different stages of stagnation. So just notice when you feel like you're stagnant and, you know, ask yourself, is my desire for God still there? Is my longing for God still there? Is my longing to deal with my emotions still there? You know, do I really have this passion for God? Because this is what it's all about, really, in the end.
Can I just add to that, too, that if you haven't, be honest with it. Because I haven't. I've got a lot of anger towards God, and it doesn't help trying to basically bullshit yourself to tell yourself this is what I should be doing. I should be loving God. I should be desiring God. Well, I just don't. And I've got a lot of anger about, like, that's why. And I need to confront all that. Feeling, like, just left and desolate and abandoned and things like that. And a lot of anger towards what happened.
So just, if you feel honest, angry, just go for it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell God about that.
Yeah.
God just wants honesty.
Yeah. Thank you.
a moment of craziness, perhaps? I don't have any recall of that, but it's not really a wise choice, it feels like. Party trick or something. It's not really smart. I don't know, maybe, like the gentleman said over here, maybe it's... I think I'll rewind back to when I was talking to AJ for about 4 hours that day. I was asking him, so I don't like religious stuff really at all. I was brought up as a Catholic, but I'm not really into any of that, and just didn't resonate with me. I didn't really have any draw towards God, or couldn't even say the word about 3 years ago. And Jesus, I just called the J-man. That was about all as far as I go there. I thought he was cool, like as in the religious side, I thought that guy was all right. I used to like story time at churches and stuff, but kind of like the moral sort of stuff, they were okay. Used to like going home even better, that was awesome. So I was asking him about this 14, I was saying, why are they all these religious dudes and stuff like that? I started getting a bit annoyed, like, is he just a religious, you know, freak that wants to like say all these, you know, religion's the way to go, so, or something like that? And I was asking him, why wouldn't, sort of like, I don't know much about religion, I'll just throw them out there. Muhammad, why wouldn't Muhammad come back? And why wouldn't Allah, whatever that is, come back? Or why wouldn't Krishna? I don't know any of these things, I'm probably all wrong saying them, but all these other people that other religions look up to or something like that. So why wouldn't they come back? You know, why was it there's these certain few? And he explained to me, because they understood about divine truth, they've gone down that path, whereas the other ones haven't understood it, and about God, the truth about that. And that kind of made sense at the time. I really lost track where I was going to now.
Why you come back?
Yeah. I was going to say something, but I forget it. It's to do with that
he
discussion.
Feels he was misled by me.
I don't know where I was going with that, but I've just totally lost it.
I have memories of what actually happened in the spirit world when we all decided to come back. But at the moment, I haven't talked to the rest of the 14 about them, because I want them to... They need to do all of their own emotional work, and if I tell them things, then there's, you know, it's like when you get told things sometimes, you know, you have a tendency then to go along and believe that for a bit, not trusting your own emotional experience. So it's really important the 14 trust their own emotional experience, just like you do, and so I haven't said much to them about it.
Remembered. just like I was saying about the gentleman over here saying how, you know, all these other ones that have come back, you know, they're all in sort of a good position and a good place, and people kind of looked up to them a little bit, whereas me, they, who did, sort of thing, everybody hated me, really, right to the very end, so.
I loved you, man.
Yeah, I know. And, so it's just, I suppose it's in a way, I can see it now, I understand why that decision would have been made. It's to show people it's possible from any condition in life, you know, to work through stuff and still, because love's real. You know, it took me a long time to realise that, and even now it's still a hard concept, because I'm not allowing it to come in, just because of the injury stuff, and I'm getting through that. So it's possible for absolutely everybody, not just people, you know, that's supposed to be up there, all, you know, that people think are important. The most unimportant person can get it, and have be loved.
There's this common concept that the people in the spirit world that are the most developed are those the ones that are the most famous. And the truth is that people in the spirit world that are the most developed are actually just common people. And many of them you would have never ever heard of in history. There's not even a word written down about them in history. And some of the ones who have returned, some of the 14 who have returned, you would have never ever heard of in your day-to-day life or in the Bible record or in the history record, and yet they have had the development, the longing for God's love to enter them so strong that they develop more rapidly than many other people, the majority of other people obviously, in history. So you know, understand that the way God selects things is not the way you often think. The way we often think is, oh, that person's got that amazing ability and that person's got that amazing gift and that, aren't they so special? But often from God's perspective, you're even more special. Just acknowledging that they're special. And many times those people that you're pointing at saying they're special wouldn't even acknowledge you. So therefore they are actually in God's eyes, they are lesser than you in the sense of they have less love within them than you do. You understand? So you see, the way God sees everything is via this love condition, not via what we see as valuable. It's very important to understand that. So at the moment, many of you just feel you're just the ordinary, normal Australian, you know, ochre person. And the truth is that many of you are going to be world-renowned historically. Right? But not because you desire it. It's just because of you getting into that state where you're at one with God and showing others how to get into that state yourself.
Just accidentally.
It's just going to be accidental, yeah. In a way.
The discovery of the truth often seems to me to be so haphazard. it's not spelled out anywhere. It just, you discover it, it comes up inside, or you miss it somewhere.
Yeah. Well, this is where I said it, that you have to keep on knocking and keep on asking. Truth comes, but to the person who seeks it the most. And it's very important to have that seeking attitude to truth. And remember, it's not an attitude here. It's an attitude here that you have in your heart towards seeking truth. So when you have that seeking feeling, that emotional feeling towards truth, then you will get the truth quite easily. It's because of the resistance that we have that that we often avoid truth. And in the first century, I don't even know if I brought a Bible with me. Here we go. He's going to quote the Bible up now.
Just been reading my thoughts. I hate that little book.
Deal with the emotion, mate. Yeah.
Not dealing.
And this was a verse in the Bible that really appealed to me even in the first century. And I used to quote things from the prophets quite a lot in the first century. And the reason why I did was because there were just so many really good truths that could be illustrated by the words, you know. And one of the things that I used to come against quite often, obviously, in the first century was the feeling of resistance in people. And you know that in yourself, even at times, you could feel that resistance within you with something I've said, right? Can't you? You just feel it sort of, oh, that grates on me. What did you say that for? And you just, there's that wall that comes up inside of us, and it affects us quite strongly. And there's a Bible verse I used to quote from the book of Isaiah about that. And I'll just read it. By hearing, you will hear, but by no means get the sense of it. And looking, you will see. You will look, but by no means see. For the heart of this people has grown unreceptive. And with their ears, they have heard without response. And they have shut their eyes, that they might never see with their eyes and hear with their ears and get the sense of it with their hearts and turn back, and I heal them. So what God's saying to you is that if you want to shut down yourself and you want to not see things, then that's what is going to be your reality. And if you block your heart to anything, if you block your heart to absolutely anything, in other words, you block your emotional experience to anything, what will happen is you will get into an unresponsive state at some point. And the key in this progression of divine love is for you to never block your heart. If you never block your heart, you will progress so rapidly. And that's why there's been many, many people who are not recognized on earth who have progressed the most rapidly, because they have had an open, responsive heart. They have not shut themselves down by when they hear something and it just makes them aggravated. They realize, oh, I'm aggravated, so there's something in me. You know what I mean? They let themselves see the truth about what's going on. And when you do that, you don't block your ears and block your, you know, close your eyes to truth. So the truth is that God wants to give you the truth. Like God, you know, I used to say quite often that, you know, you don't ask for bread and get something else from God. You don't get a stone. You get bread. You know, if you ask God from your heart, you'll get what you ask for. Often, though, what we're doing when it comes to truth is we're not asking for it here. We think we are here, but here we're not. And so that's very important, to get into that mode of asking for truth and longing for truth all the time. Yeah. So if I'm in an angry state, like I feel, you know, I'm in this angry state at the moment, the angry state that I'm in is about not wanting to take responsibility for the things that I've already taken responsibility for historically. Do you follow me? Like, so you know, all these different spheres and there's all sorts of things going on in the spirit world at the moment that I'm taking responsibility for, and there's all these things, this responsibility comes with the love that enters you, but I don't want to do it. Like, I feel really resistive. I feel like it's more a duty than a passion. And because of that, there's a fair bit of anger in me about that, about there's a feeling that I have in me that I want my personal life to sort out first, and then I'll do it. You know, there's that kind of feeling there too, right? And so I've got to face that truth, that this is how I'm feeling right now. This is how I'm feeling. I've also got to face the truth that how I'm feeling is an emotional error from God's perspective. And I've got to face that truth as well. And then I've got to face, do I want to experience this emotion? So let myself experience the rage that I feel about being forced down a path that at the moment I still don't really feel comfortable with. You follow me? Mm-hmm. And let myself go through all of those emotions, because they are the blocking emotions. So you'll notice these things happening in your own life too, right? Where you're blocking something, you feel angry about something, you feel resistive about something. Mm-hmm. Notice it, deal with it, let yourself feel it, be honest about it, be honest about it with God and yourself. And then you'll progress really, really rapidly. Don't close down. Don't close down. As soon as you close down, you'll walk away. And then in 10 years' time or 15 years' time or however long you've closed down, you'll look back on it when you reopen up and think, that was a waste of my life. There's no need to waste your life. Just stay open. Just stay open. Yeah.
Is the rapture really going to happen?
Is the rapture going to happen? Who's heard of the rapture?
I had it last night.
Okay, quite a few. You were in rapture last night.
Prehistoric bird.
I won't ask why you're in rapture. We'll stay away from that.
I was playing music.
Oh, okay. Okay. No worries. The rapture Bible definition is that there'll be a time when all of those who are on earth who are in a state of divine truth get called to God. And the answer is no, that's not how it works. God's laws are not broken for a group of people. So the truth is that, you know, a lot of these teachings came to try to motivate people to stick with a certain type of philosophy, and also to motivate people to, like, there's this common viewpoint, believe in Jesus and you'll be saved, which basically is saying you've got no, you know, you've got no emotional responsibility for anything you do. As long as you believe in Jesus, you'll be saved. And as long as you do that, you'll go, this rapture will occur and you'll be taken to God.
And I believed. It didn't help me one ounce.
Exactly, yeah. But Corny's personal experience was, he believed that what I was saying was true, but it didn't help him a single bit until he was willing to experience it all emotionally. And that took another 70 years after his passing. Right? And that truth is always going to be the truth. Now, obviously, it's going to be a lot easier when there's thousands of people on earth dealing with their stuff like you're dealing. Tens of thousands, or hundreds of thousands, or millions of people progressing in divine love. Then obviously, the next person who comes along to do it, it's going to find it a lot easier than the first one who did it. Right? Being the first people who do it, you're basically bucking against a system of things, which I call the world of this, you know, this world that we live in, that we need to be not a part of. But, you know, we're bucking against this system of things until we get into a state of oneness. But even then, we're still sort of pushing against the system until lots and lots of other people join us. And that's one of the emotions I've got to deal with at the moment, is I want lots of people to join me before I do the next bit. And I've got to get away from that as well, you know, because that's another thing holding me back.
You mean join me in an emotional state?
Yeah, join me in the emotional state.
Get into
a
better state?
Yeah.
Of love?
Yep.
But the Bible said, all eyes will see you, and yet you came before. So how can I
tell that to my daughter? She
well, all eyes will see me.
Yes.
But we'll talk about future plans. There are future plans. I also said in the first century that I'd come like a thief in the night. Yeah. So how do we marry those two verses up? People quote one thing out of the Bible, hold on to that, but are not honest with themselves, because there's another thing in the Bible that says almost exactly the opposite, right? And if they were honest with themselves, they'd say, hang on a sec, one's saying that he will be, all I will see him, the other one's saying that he'll be coming as a thief in the night. If he was coming as a thief in the night, how can all eyes see him? Mm. Like, that doesn't make much sense to me. I don't know if it makes much sense to you.
Yes, it does to me.
The truth is, both of those things will happen.
Yeah. Yeah.
But not in the way people imagine. Yeah.
So is it worth reading the Bible at all? Or should you go to that page or something?
The Bible has a lot of truths in it. It does. But a lot of the divine truths are there. But the actual truth of the new birth is only one passage in the Bible that mentions it. And that's the passage in John 3, where I was talking to Nicodemus. So unfortunately, the thing that was the most thing that I talked about in the first century is the thing that's mentioned the least in the Bible. Right? So my suggestion is, yes, read the Paget messages. They are a much closer account of what happened in the first century, as well as a much closer account of the truth of the spirit world and the truth about your own development. And if you can incorporate your emotional development in that, you'll grow a lot faster. Now, there's a lot of things in the Bible that help you with emotional development, if you're willing to see them as that. But there's also quite a lot of errors there. And so you will, at times, be frustrated with it.
Can I have another dig at the Bible?
You can dig as much as you
want. Awesome. To me, it's like this is fun. It reminds me of like the Da Vinci Code. It had some really good fact in there, but also it was mixed in with fiction. So that's what made the bestseller. Kind of true?
Yeah,
very true.
It's the same with the Bible too, eh?
Yeah, it's just the
fact and fiction mixed together makes a good seller.
That's what I reckon, the same.
What about other holy books like the Quran or something? Is there anything in there?
There's a lot of good truths in a lot of holy books, particularly natural love truths. So if you're interested in understanding natural love more, there's a lot of truths in a lot of these books. Of course, you've got to remember the climate in which they were written. Almost all of these holy books were written in a climate that was men dominant. And so the climate, obviously, when... I don't know how many of you women feel the Bible is not so good for you, but I'd agree. The Bible itself portrays things for women in many cases not as well as it does for men, and the issue, there's some big issues with that. Obviously, you're basically cutting out half of the soul straight away as soon as you do that. So there are truths in a lot of these books. There's a lot of good channeled material too that's really, really good. Natural love channeled material, but good.
I was going to say, I was talking to a girl about the soul once, and next time I saw her, she gave me, I don't know how many pages you can find on the internet about it, but she gave them all to me, about all different religions, their versions of it. And so I read them all, and it's actually, it was some one I didn't even expect, had a really, probably the closest version of what the soul was. So other people have got some good, like there's lots of things in the mix, isn't there, really?
Yeah, I like what Socrates said about the soul. Have you heard what Socrates said? He said that a soul is a friend in two different bodies. Which is interesting. A Course in Miracles was channeled. Now we're sort of getting off the topics of first century. That's fine though. Everyone want to get off that, or you've had enough of that? Well, A Course in Miracles was channeled by a first sphere spirit who progressed into the second sphere while channeling the material. It wasn't channeled by myself. He was a deep believer in Jesus. But as his concepts were very biblical in nature about my life and myself, and so he related all those things. The spirit who channeled it is now on the divine path. So he has since moved onto the divine path rather than on the Course of Miracles. What actually happened was that the people channeling it believed him to be Jesus, and he didn't correct them. Right. So he didn't actually lie to them. He just didn't correct their own assumption. This happens a lot, by the way, with channeling from spirits. Spirit comes to you, you believe that they're somebody, they'll often, in order to maintain a connection with you, not tell you any different. If they're a divine love spirit, they will not do that. Mm. If they're a natural love spirit, they'll do that.
Lying by omission.
Yeah, basically it's not telling the truth by omission. So there are actually penalties associated with it, unbeknown to them, but they're all to do with divine love, the laws of divine love. Yeah.
Are there spirits who believe they're Jesus? Like,
yeah, hundreds of thousands.
Yeah, so
of them.
There are spirits who believe they're God.
Yeah, there's billions of spirits who believe they're God. Yeah, literally. Billions of spirits.
So there may be messages coming through, they're not intentionally falsely saying who they are. They really think they are.
That's right. They really believe they are. Mm. Many, a lot don't believe they are either.
Yeah.
So there's a mixture. It depends what condition they're in. You can often tell by the message. So if the message contains a lot of doom and gloom and really negative things, and it's saying it's from Jesus, well, obviously it's probably a pretty negative spirit, probably in the first sphere. If there's somebody getting a message from God talking about reincarnation in the old way of believing, if I could use that term, then obviously it's a spirit who's in a certain condition who believes in reincarnation. It just depends on the condition of the spirit. Now, a lot of times they're not lying. They sincerely believe what they're saying to you to be the truth.
If we ask, this is just on the God, the spirit thing again.
Yeah.
If we ask God for divine love and to be on the divine assistance, do you automatically, your guides be on the divine love path?
No. The reason why is because asking here and asking here are two different things.
Mm.
What are you going to do to be on the divine love path? You've got to have a longing for God in your heart for God's love to enter you. In your heart, not here.
Mm.
You've also got to have in your heart a longing to deal with all of your own emotions and to listen to truth in your heart. Now, if you don't have it in your heart, then you won't attract the spirit who will help you. It's only if it's in your heart that you'll get it. So it's not what's going on in your head that matters. And this is where a lot of people get mixed up. They say, oh, but I asked for God's protection. Why didn't I get it? Well, the truth is that God's already protecting you as well as God wants to protect you with the laws that are in place that God has already put in place to protect you. Right? Like, he's already doing it. If you ask for God's additional protection, God will certainly give it, but not, he's not going to do it and let you break his laws doing it. So like, oh, I want to have God's protection, but I'm going to become a racing car driver now, right? Now, I'm going to get some protection, but if I'm risking my life, purposefully risking my life just to get an adrenaline rush, which is based around an emotional condition, then what do I got to do? I've got to look at the emotional condition. That's saying God's protecting me. Now, he had a lot of mates doing the same thing. He had six mates doing the same thing, and four of them died in 1 year. So then they all say, what, God wasn't protecting them? What was happening was that they weren't dealing with their emotional condition within themselves. So how can God work with that? He can't. You see, a lot of times we're fooling ourselves when it comes to what we're asking for. So the key is to be really sincere. Like, I was feeling really blocked last week, and I wasn't being sincere. I've got all this anger that's there about different issues, but I wasn't allowing myself to connect with it, and I wasn't even allowing myself to recognize it was within me. So of course I'm going to feel disconnected from God in that state, until I'm willing and open to see something different. Yeah.
AJ,
yeah.
With healing, most of the New Agers, if you say there's some sickness, they say, oh, what don't you want to see? Or, oh, you're supposed to be learning some lesson. But God wouldn't give you a sickness for you to learn to still love God.
God doesn't give you sicknesses at all.
Because I notice in myself there's still a belief that, oh, I'm supposed to still
I'm
love.
I'm supposed to do something.
Yeah.
Or, yeah.
And
yeah.
What is it?
Yep.
So how does that healing work? Is it still just a call in your own heart for wholeness?
Well, there's a couple of things at work. Firstly, a spirit can, through another person, heal you in your spirit body and your physical body. But if you don't deal with the emotion, then that healing will not be permanent. And this is why a lot of people have to go back to them, right? So you get healed this week, but in a month's time you feel the same pain again. Why is that? Because the emotion isn't dealt with, right? So that's what's happening from a healing perspective, from a spirit. Most healing that's happening on the earth is from a spirit doing that on the natural love path. In terms of healing going on within yourself, every single illness you have is a creation of your own emotional denial. Every sickness, every bodily function, every single feeling in your body, every pain you have, everything to do with that is all about denial. It's all about what you're denying. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so with the prayer from my heart is to confront every denial that's there.
That's right, and the key to it is to be open about that, and the handout I've just given, which we'll probably talk about more tomorrow, is about how to look at your denials. Because it's the denial that creates sickness. So every single sickness, every single body pain, even your body not operating properly, if you feel you're overweight, all of that is all about denial. The whole lot is all about denial. The key is to allow yourself to see where you're denying, right? And to deal with that.
And when
Grant, you're wanting to have a break.
No, it's just that those people are leaving. They might be booked in for tomorrow. Are we going to run tomorrow?
Yeah, I was going to run tomorrow.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
I was have to run after them.
But it may not be as long.
Yeah, it's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, David, would you still speak about your death and the resurrection and the ascension?
Sure. I haven't covered that, have I?
Yeah.
So, what was I up to? I was up to the night. I was brought before the Sanhedrin. I suppose I could be facetious with all this and humorous, but I...
What you're angry at.
Hey? Or I can get all angry about it, which is probably going to be better for me.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll just need to let myself connect emotionally to all this as well while I'm saying it, hopefully. So yeah, Judas came up. He did kiss me, like a greeting, you know, like they do in Europe in particular. Indicating to the soldiers that I was the man. And the soldiers were soldiers that were a mixture of soldiers. They were Roman soldiers, but they were given to the Sanhedrin to maintain order in the temple. So they were the soldiers that came to get me. And they bound me and took me off. And brought me before this a hastily prepared Sanhedrin court. There were 71 members in the Sanhedrin. My own father was one of the members. But they didn't invite all of the members who had any liking for me. So they only invited the members who wanted me dead. The Sanhedrin court was split in half because of my teachings, basically. There were half of them who really loved the teachings of divine truth. And there were the other half who hated them with vengeance. The half that hated them with a vengeance was all about money, actually, and power. It was all about them losing the power over the people. Because I was promoting a direct relationship with God, with each individual. They were promoting a relationship with God through the priesthood. So obviously a totally different concept. And they were earning over 30 tons of gold every year from the people. So you were talking like huge, huge sums nowadays. You're talking, I think in nowadays terms it's like $5 or $6 billion or something every single year was coming in from like just people just being raped of all this money. So it was a huge business. And my actions were destroying it. And so there was a lot of anger and rage towards me at the Sanhedrin. And so I was bound they, you know, they'd come up and hit me or punch me and spit in my face and all that kind of stuff. And then they'd, you know, they brought in so-called witnesses who had never seen me, accusing me of things that I'd never done, things like that. And eventually the court decided, without me actually saying a word, the court decided that that I should be executed. But they decided they couldn't do it themselves. They didn't want to do it themselves for a lot of reasons, because if they did it themselves, there were quite a lot of Jews now who were supportive of me, and they felt that there'd be a huge revolt, and they wanted to control a revolt. They thought that if they killed me, then they were quite slimy men, right? Really, a lot of them. They were really politically savvy, and so they made some decisions that they wanted to get me involved, with the Romans, so the Romans would kill me. So they sent me to Pilate, took me to Pilate, and Pilate was in a it's just come here for some reason. Pilate's still in the fifth sphere of the spirit world. Now, as we speak, he's not yet in the sixth sphere, and he's just come to visit. So, anyway, but they took me to Pilate, and myself and Pilate had a long discussion, actually, around an hour or so, where we were talking about truth. He was questioning me to determine whether I wanted to be king of the Jews and all those kind of things. And I told him, you know, my kingdom's no part of this world. And if it were, that my attendants would have fought for me, and I didn't want them to fight. It wasn't about that. It was about something that was going on in the spirit world. And I talked to him about the spirit world. And I talked to him about truth, the importance of truth, the importance of God's truth, divine truth, and quite a few other things. And he basically ended our conversation with, what is truth anyway? You know, he got so frustrated with the conversation. But he took me out onto a, very similar to how it shows it on the Passion, and presented me to the people and said, look, I don't find any fault with him. So I don't feel that he should be killed, you know.
He was also afraid of his own...
He was very afraid.
Because of political stuff that was going on.
Yeah, he was very afraid of his own position, because what was happening is that there was a change in government in Rome that was affecting his livelihood in Jerusalem. He was skimming lots of money from the temple. So what? There was a lot of money things going on where the
Sejanus, wasn't it? Sejanus was looking after administrator for the emperor, Tiberius, at the time. Because Tiberius didn't want to do it, so he put a person he believed in charge to do it. That person was his best friend at first. Then he started seeing himself possibly in that position, but he didn't have that position, you know, from his upbringing sort of thing, or through rank or whatever it was. So he started trying to milk the money to try and put bribes everywhere to get himself in that position.
Mm.
His idea was to assassinate Tiberius then, but he'd become aware of this and had Sejanus killed, and all of his followers that knew about it, all the family, anybody that come and grieve for that person, so there'd be no more uprising about it. But Pilate also was a person who was in charge of skimming all the money from all the taxes there to try and fund all the stuff he wanted to do. And Pilate somehow escaped being noticed. So he was shitting himself, basically, of being found out. So he didn't want any uprisings to do with anything. He just wanted to keep it all quiet and let the Jews bugger off. You know, you sort out your man.
Yeah. So Pilate had a lot of reasons to stay away from the whole issue. He got forced into it by the Sanhedrin, and they had agitators in the crowd saying, you know, he's calling himself a king of the Jews, which I wasn't, obviously, but that's what they kept on saying. He's calling himself king of the Jews. We have no king but Caesar. And, you know, really, really getting into Pilate, like, you know, this is going to affect you with Caesar if you do something here. And so Pilate firstly came up with an idea that they were just angry with me. And so he decided just to have me flogged. So I got taken away to be flogged, but he gave instructions that I wasn't flogged too much, but the soldiers were quite angry with me, and so they flogged me pretty badly. I couldn't hardly stand up after the flogging, and it was pretty much like it's shown in the Passion, pretty much blood everywhere. And they propped me up in front of the crowd now, hoping that my bloody mess would sort of calm them all down, and they'd look at what they'd done and they'd just give it away, you know? But they didn't, so... So that's when the soldiers sort of whacked a crown of thorns on my head, and they did a bit of water torture type stuff with me as well, and brutalized me, my private parts and things like that as well. And they sort of presented me back to the crowd. And by this time, obviously a lot of the people who were with me knew what was happening. And Mary was actually not in Jerusalem at the time, but she was, by this time, she was now in Jerusalem. So she watched a lot of this happening as well. And my mother was there, and my mother's sister, and John's mother, and Apostle John's himself was there, and quite a lot of the other of the disciples had scattered by this time because they were worried about what would happen to them. And so then I was just basically had to walk, I suppose, you could say. It was Pilate wanted to didn't want to crucify me. But the crowd called out for my crucifixion, and the problem was too is there was this other man, Barabbas, who, in fact, his name was Jesus, believe it or not, not Barabbas. So you know, in the Bible, it talks about this man Barabbas who was a thief and a murderer. His actual name was Jesus. So there were two Jesus.
Which one do you want?
Which one do you want? And they freed. The reason why they freed one of us was that it was a common custom to grant a pardon for somebody on the Passover, which is happening once a year, right? It was a once a year event. So, you know, of all the political prisoners that were kept in prison, one prisoner got a pardon. And so the other Jesus got a pardon.
That's incidentally why they tried to get that over and done with really quick.
Mm.
So it'd be over and done with before the Sabbath, or their holy day,
yeah,
celebrations.
They wanted it done, and it was only now about 6 hours before the evening. So, and if it was unlawful for a person, a Jew, to touch a bloody body on the Sabbath, so anybody who died on the Sabbath was left to the following day to be prepared, generally. And so what happened was that I had to carry this stake. It wasn't a cross, it was just a pole up the mount to Golgotha. And I was so exhausted that I couldn't carry it very far. And then a big man, Simon, his name was, stepped in and helped me carry it. In fact, he probably carried me and it up to the top of the mound. And Corny was overseeing all this procession. So Cornelius was the centurion overseeing the whole crucifixion of the three people, not just myself. The other two people they crucified the Roman way, which was with a cross. But Pilate wanted to make a statement that it was to do with the Jews' decision and not his decision. So, and one of the reasons why he wanted to make that statement is that I knew his wife, and his wife had dreams about me being, you know, a son of God and all those kind of things, and in the sense of the born again sense. And so she was really superstitious with me and about me, and so she was trying to get Pilate to not do it. And so he had a lot of pressure from her, but the pressure coming from Caesar or from the threat of his life was far greater. So he decided to crucify me, but to crucify me on a stake instead of a cross, which meant hanging like so rather than like so. And so Corny's already described how he nailed the nail into my wrist at the top, and then and I was looking at Corny with love, and he just threw down the hammer, and he didn't do my feet. So another one of the soldiers, like those other soldiers were a bit confused because he was the actual
in charge.
So, you know, they didn't know what to do for a while, and then they decided they've got to keep going with the crucifixion. So they nailed my feet. And probably the worst thing for me at the time was just seeing my soulmate's sadness. And sort of now I sort of feel a bit like before then I felt like I'd made the right decision, like it was a decision to allow this to occur. But watching my soulmate's heart die just brought lots of, like, it was just quite sad to watch that happen. And you know, she went from being this beautiful, joyful spirit to being just this really terrified and joyless person. And I felt one of the feelings I had after I passed was that I'd destroyed her, you know, in a way. But my mother was there, and John was there, and a few other women were there, not many men. It wasn't like a great crowd of people there, just a few people. Because it was Passover was coming up, they decided that they needed to break my legs so that when you're hanging from a stake, your whole body rips in half from just under your rib cage, and all of your internal organs tear apart. And so they thought that I'd have to do that. They thought I'd have to break my legs to make all the bottom half of the weight of my body just tear everything apart and kill me. But what happened was that because I was so sort of sensitive to everything emotionally, and because of the beating that I had, I bled to death before then. And not just, there was no muscular strength left in me anymore to hold myself together as there would normally be. A lot of people died in 2 or 3 days on a cross instead of just in 6 hours. But in my case, I died in just under 6 hours. And my body did tear apart, and that's how I died. And then I left my body just as anybody does. And I watched the rest from the spirit world. So I was there while, you know, they stuck a spear in my body, and I don't have any emotions about any of that now even, because it was just something I observed, if that makes sense. But the things I do have emotions about are just watching how sad and terrible all of the ones who were there present who loved me felt, you know, and particularly Mary. And just the terrible emotions that they went through. They pulled me down off the cross or off the stake, and Mary just wept for quite a few hours into the evening. And then they carried my body off to be prepared for burial, which took the next day. And they didn't do it on the next day because it was Sabbath, so the following day afterwards they were allowed to do it, so they prepared my body for burial and buried me that day. But I was watching all of these things in the spirit world, and obviously I was comfortable with what was happening, but nobody else was. So then they put me in the tomb, which was actually my father's tomb. He'd bought a tomb when he bought a house. He bought a house in Jerusalem when I was in my 20s. And he bought a tomb in Jerusalem as well, because he felt he always wanted to be buried in the holy city. And so I was placed in the tomb. And what I did as soon as I was placed in a tomb and it was closed over, I destroyed the physical body. Like, I made the physical body disappear. Just go into it. Basically, you know how bodies disappear over time? Well, what I did was just hasten that process so that the body disappeared within an hour or so. And the process of that happening meant that the shroud was left there over the top, but no body. So I folded up the shroud and put it in the corner at the head of the tomb. It was like a rock that I was laying on. And I did that because I wanted to demonstrate that I'd done it. Do you know what I mean? That I'd actually done something, that something had happened here. I knew the tomb would at some point be rolled open. And there were a number of six-sphere and celestial spirits who caused the rolling. They materialized the body and rolled the tomb door open. The soldiers fled when it occurred. There were two or three soldiers guarding the tomb and they fled. And then when Mary came the next morning, Mary Magdalene came the next morning, obviously the tomb was open and my body was gone. And she thought somebody had stolen me, stolen my body. But then as she came out of the tomb, I appeared before her. I pulled together a physical body and appeared before her and gave her a hug. And as soon as I did that, she realized, because my form looked a bit different, she realized that it was me. And then she ran back to where the other disciples who were still in Jerusalem were hiding and told them that she'd seen me, and they had told her that she's crazy. And they told her that it's not possible, and they told her that quite a few things actually, along with being a stupid woman and why you're just emotional and all that kind of stuff. And she was saying, no, 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 you know. And eventually John and Peter believed her enough to actually run to the tomb and have a look. And when they ran to the tomb, they went in and seen my body was gone, and they thought the same thing as she thought. And then when they came back out again, I appeared to them. And so by this time, there's three of them now who had seen the same thing. And then over the next 50 days, I appeared to nearly 500 people.
In a materialized body.
In a materialized body, yeah. So you know how this resurrection thing, people say it was a resurrected physical body. Well, it wasn't. I was just a normal spirit now, just like you will be when you pass. And when you have the power coming from God, you can materialize a form. And this happens all the time, by the way. I've had some interactions already with different spirits who, and some of the different people I know have had interactions with spirits that I know were spirits who had materialized a form. And it happens all the time. It happens quite commonly, actually. So I materialized a form on lots and lots of different occasions. And then I actually got quite a lot of them together when I left them. And I sort of took my form up into the clouds, if you like, just to demonstrate that I was in a different state, really. So a lot of the things that I tried to demonstrate are now misinterpreted, though. So, I was just trying to demonstrate a lot of different truths in the process, but a lot of times it was misinterpreted. But it affected my soulmate really badly, the whole events, and she was 6 months pregnant as well, so it affected my daughter, our unborn daughter, really badly too. And there's a lot of emotions that I'm going through right now about that, about how much those events affected them. Yes. Is there any other questions you want to ask about it? Like, there's a lot more detail I can give probably, but...
What are the kind of things that you said to those disciples when you materialized them, or what were they asking of you?
I would remind them of conversations that I had with them about the spirit body and about the soul, and about its power when you pass. I'd remind them about, you know, soul development, what the soul development's all about. And we'd often have conversations where for a long time they'd be talking to me and they didn't realize who they were talking to. And then all of a sudden they would get who they're talking to, and I'd just smile at them and give them a hug or whatever and then leave, you know. And so a lot of times we'd have a long conversation before they realized who they were speaking with. And there was also, my brother Thomas was a really outspoken man, and he was really shocked about my death, as were all of my family. But he was really outspoken about it. You know, he was saying, like, you know, none of it's true. You know, what, we're idiots. We're all idiots to believe all this crap, you know, that he was telling us. And, you know, he was quiet. He went into this real angry phase of grief, you know, that grief-stricken anger type phase. And a lot of people were listening to him. A lot of the disciples were listening to him. And he eventually fled because he thought he would be one of the people who would be chased by the Romans to actually be killed as well. So he fled. And as he was fleeing, I stopped him on the road and talked to him about what was really going on, and asked him to go back. And I told him that I'd appear to the whole, to a whole group of them inside of a room if they locked the door. And I told them if they set it up how I'd like it to be set up, I'll appear to them and show him that I'm telling the truth, that it was all true. And that was the time, you know, it's recorded in the Bible about Thomas the Doubter. It was my brother, Thomas. And what I did is materialized a body that still had holes in my wrists that he could poke his finger through and feel that it was actually flesh, because he wasn't convinced otherwise. So I did that, and I appeared in a room that was in a locked house, just to demonstrate to quite a few people there. There were quite a few of my friends there, just to demonstrate to them that, you know, I was still alive, you know. And it was the demonstration that I was still alive that became so real to them. And so they worked through lots and lots of grief during this period, obviously. And then on top of that, having that demonstration that I was still alive increased their faith so much. You know, just their faith before was quite small, but after that, their faith was, like, really large. And because of that, many of them received divine love in fairly strong abundance over the next 50 days. Which caused the events of Pentecost, which, where they all got together and actually felt God's love in the, like, a room like this. It was a similar amount of people to hear this actually too, and they felt God's love enter them, and they all had different experiences as a result of that love entering them, and they were fully convinced of everything after that point. And that's, so I didn't need to be on earth anymore after that, really. So what I did after that was by this time my child Sarah wasn't born yet, but Mary had to flee to Egypt, and Sarah was born in Egypt, and I became Sarah's guide and guardian. It's the only person I've ever been a guide or a guardian to, is my daughter. And then about... the authorities found out where they were, so they fled there and they went to France on a ship. And I spent most of my time after that teaching in the spirit world, teaching as many people as I could on earth in a spirit state, and spending a lot of time with Mary and Sarah as well. But by this stage, Mary was quite grief-stricken and quite angry with me too, because she knew I'd made a choice to pass on that particular day, and she felt she wasn't ready, and so there was lots of anger that she felt towards me, and still does actually.
What happened? Where's Thomas now?
He's a celestial spirit. Yeah. He's actually in the one-man state with his soulmate, so in the 22nd sphere. As are, like, there's nearly 20,000 souls in that state now, and the majority of them. Well, a lot of them were ones from the first century that I knew. So my mum and dad are in that state as well. All my brothers are in that state. My two sisters are not quite in that state yet. Pretty much all my family's in that state. Yeah. But when I was on earth, none of them believed. Even my mother, you know, it's a common misconception that my mother believed and supported me the entire way through. My mother did support me at the end, but even at the end she was still very confused. she was proud of me but very confused about everything I was saying. But she would often follow me around saying I was crazy to everyone for different reasons. You know, sometimes it was to try and protect me from people. Other times it was because she did think I was crazy. And she went through a stage where she just thought that I went into a sort of a religious zealot mode. You know, she felt that I'd just become this religious nutter, and she did feel I was crazy for a long time. And it was only right near the end that she could start feeling some divine love flowing for her listening to the teachings that she didn't feel that. But she felt, my father felt cursed for having me as his son. And he just felt that I was, he felt that I was his shame. So I've had quite a few emotions to deal with about that this time around. But after I passed, he realized that actually what I was speaking was the truth, and after I'd reappeared. So then his shame turned into his own self-torture, really, right? And so my father went into this place of feeling really upset with himself for not realizing the truth earlier, and because of his guilt, he left the family home, and he just traveled talking about the truth. But a lot of it was driven by his own strong feelings of guilt.
Did he pass into the first sphere?
My father, no. He passed in the second sphere. My mother passed into the third sphere. My soulmate passed into the third sphere, but still had first sphere emotions. All of them had first sphere emotions to deal with, but their soul condition was in a different place each time. So my soulmate passed into she could have gone to the third sphere, but she had first sphere emotions to deal with. She was tortured to death, so had a lot of emotions to deal with about her torture. And she had a lot of feelings towards me as well, of rage with me, rage. Like, we had a period of time in our lives, a year and a half, we spent, that we were actually together and happy. And you know, like, she felt that wasn't long enough.
That's understandable.
No, I feel it wasn't long enough either.
So now you want to kick back in the woods.
Yeah, that's one of the emotions I have is like, one of my resistances is that, like, do I want to do that all again, you know? Like, and I just sometimes want to just kick back in a nice little tropical paradise and just spend all the time with my girl and what we create together. But, you know, I know that's not why I've come, but it's a feeling that's quite strong in me, you know. And it's driven by some of this guilt that I still have about choosing the past and watching my soulmate just die inside, you know.
You said your mother in the first century experienced a bit of divine love. Was it at the end of your life or at the end of her life?
At the end of my life, she started experiencing some divine love, particularly after I passed, because when somebody passes, if you have huge grief, you're actually clearing away a lot of causal emotion. And as you're clearing away this causal emotion, if you're longing to God for love, you'll receive a lot of love as well. So, you know, that happened to her. And then but it took many years before she had some peace with it all. It was nearly, you know, 15 years before she really had peace about what had happened. The Apostle John, who's known as the Apostle John now, he looked after her. She stayed with him. What happened to a lot of my friends is that they just, like, my soulmate lost all of her friends in that one instant as well. When she left, she had to abandon all of her friends to leave to save herself, and so she lost all of her friends. So if you can imagine, like, losing your partner, who you had this really loving, like, intense relationship with, that the truth is that there's probably not been anyone on earth yet who's had the relationship that we've had, together. And then she then I passed, and then within a few weeks she had to leave all of her friends, all of her family, to go to a place that she'd never been to before. And then within a few weeks after that, she gave birth to a child that she wanted me to be present with, which I was present at, actually, but, you know, of course, she couldn't feel me being present at this point. And by this point, she was quite upset with me in her grief, and so I couldn't easily appear to her without her just being angry with me anyway. So, you know, and then she had to move again after that as well, so it was pretty distressing for them. And it was very distressing for our unborn child, Sarah. And even Sarah, a lot of Sarah's emotions now that she's working through right now are related to those events.
Are we likely to meet her?
I feel you might meet Sarah in a few months, actually. She's thinking very seriously about coming to Australia with Luke. So Sarah and Luke, and I have a feeling they'll be here in a couple of months, so, or maybe even sooner. So yeah, you'll meet my girl, my daughter. I call her my princess. Sarah means princess. Yeah. Sorry? Can we have a break? No. I'm in a belligerent mood. Of course you can have a break. Let's have a break, shall we? Oh, one thing I wanted to say to everyone is that I hope you've enjoyed having the opportunity to speak with Corny, because it's fun. Yeah. A lot of times when I talk about the 14, people don't ever see any one of the others of the 14. And so therefore, you know, it's like, oh, is that really happening or not happening or what? And I just think it's been great that you've given us the opportunity to do that today. It's taken Corny probably a year to get to the state where he felt like he could cope with doing it, hasn't it, pretty much?
I'm still pretty nervous.
Yeah. So, and all of the 14 have similar issues with public exposure. For obvious reasons. Most of the time, public exposure in the first century resulted in our death. So we've got some pretty big emotions usually connected with public exposure.
There's also emotional stuff for me to stand in my own truth of how I really feel. I'm basically, I was going to say, fuck the system. Like, I've had enough of them.
Yeah.
I've been told what to do. I've been used and stuff like that to stand up for myself. I've brought around my own death. So being in truth for me is also death. So that's another... Yeah. Stumbling block as well. That's not the truth in the end too, because it never dies. As I'd rather be in truth than be imprisoned in, you know, everybody else's stuff.
Corny's first century life was quite harsh in a lot of ways, because he found the truth right at the end of his life and didn't have any time to deal with it emotionally, and then passed. And so what that meant was that he arrived in the hells of the spirit world, still having to deal with all these emotions, but believing a different truth. And that was quite shocking for him. And I can remember, you know, just looking at him in that state of feeling totally disillusioned with all things for a while. And many of you will have moments of that in your own progression, where, you know, you'll go along for a while doing all of this work, emotional work, and you'll get to a sticking point inside of yourself emotionally, and you'll feel this a time of disillusionment. And being disillusioned with love and disillusioned with God and disillusioned with truth is a big emotion inside of a lot of people. Yeah.
I think I might even read, I've got something there I might read actually, I might promote some emotional stuff for you guys. Just a little purple book. It's a little diary, sort of kept sometimes, just writing. I hate writing diaries. My emotion with that one was that I'll be exposed if somebody finds it. I don't want to, that was before I knew any of this stuff, even from in high school, we had to write a diary, and I just wrote in that, handing to the teacher, I don't want to write the diary. That's why I don't want to show anybody my emotions. But so I did this to trigger myself a bit anyway, but just to write down during the day what I was feeling and try and just go beyond what the trigger was and just see what was deeper underneath it. And something that came up was pretty interesting one day, I might just read to you. It was probably about a year ago now. It was to do with all this stuff we're talking about today, a bit about my life. I'm just trying to find and get past the part that just triggered me. I was just my life stuff, like now stuff. Something about being disconnected to my feelings, feeling aloof, but being, when somebody's asking you how you're feeling, like it's a bit of a confrontational sort of thing, and I just felt really I don't know. I just felt a bit uneasy about that, and I was just going through it. I was reading about one of the things AJ did a little print off on his CD, it's just a burning desire for God. And realised feeling inside of me just not being worthy of love. And it, then I wrote, kept going. It came from being taken away. The error I know is that I felt I was not saved, not protected by my parents. And felt as if my mother didn't have to love me, didn't love me because of it. I was never saved. No one came to save me. That love was gone, that feeling of so much of it, and then having it taken away in an instant and never getting it back. Always hoping until just seemed to fade away. Hope just seemed to fade away. Then just living in anger and resentment at life, having it taken away again when I remembered it again, and the struggle to believe it was ever real, but remembering that it was so, just didn't want to even have that memory that it was even real to start with. And just having that feeling again and again, wanting to have that freedom and happiness that everything beyond is what any material thing can offer, meaning love. Just hated even having that memory of that feeling, because it made it hurt all the time. And it awakened my poor, desolate soul that only felt anger and pain, and my actions that demonstrated my feelings. Those poor, innocent ones that were the victims of my pain, my sorrow, my anger, the errors of my emotional errors, the guilt and shame of who I had become. There was a tiny spark inside of me somewhere, so deep that was still alive with the knowing of being loved. It was so close to burning out, but still held on. My mother finding me after all of these years, I couldn't accept it to be real or possible that the love I could remember how it was displayed and taught, not by words but by actions. But by actions and mere but powerful projected feelings that it would ever be present again. Just from that little bit, my mother came and found me when I was in Jerusalem. And it was not long before I died, and she found out where I was after all those years, after nearly 20-something years, she actually still loved me and wanted to find me. She found me because of a political incident that went on then, knew where I was stationed. And I sent her away though, just so angry at her. She'd come to a compound and somebody told me she's there and opened up the door and she kind of gave me a gift, like just wanted to love me. And just... I just sent her away, just hated her. Just brought everything up because I was feeling all that stuff coming up at that stage. Just that anger was just really directed at her, and just told her to go. I never saw her again until I saw her when I was just about to pass away. But anyway, we'll keep going. Yeah, just that love was just a myth, something that I must have made up. Love couldn't be real. My own internal war began. I could sense that there was something true, but had to keep discarding it. It hurt to believe that I was once loved, that my feelings were so remote, so foreign, it could not even be possible or real. There was this one that was going around teaching of this love thing, causing a bit of a stir amongst the people, causing a bit of a stir inside of me. I wanted to know if the spark, so small as it was inside of me, still had any credence underneath it. Underneath all the anger, the pain, and the resentment of seeing my mother, who I did not welcome but completely dismissed, I remembered that spark. I listened at times to this man. Others of my standing mocked what he had said. I did too, just to justify my position, but would in times of only myself sit with the man's words. There were many who would love to tell their stories to any fools who would listen, but this man was different, like he knew something that was inside of me. This caused me curiosity. I felt a softening inside of me, as if a bed I slept in once of thorns had now become the comfort of wool. There became more of a struggle. Who am I? This love that was once a myth became a glimpse of reality for me, so who am I? I do things that harm and cause pain to others, especially those who don't have any due to them, for they are innocent. Yet I'm no longer comfortable with this. So who am I? I wonder now of my mother and why she came so far from where she lived after nearly three decades. She's here. Did she come to find me? Did she never give up? I don't know. But did she find me? But did she find me? How sad that she found me like this. That man that speaks of love has been taken. He has stirred up a lot in everyone, but has done no harm. Harm is something that I have done. I still dishonestly to myself do what I do. They want him dead by the morning, the day they call a Sabbath. I feel numb at this. I don't want to feel. Just do what I do. He says no words of ill. I look into his eyes as I hold the nail and drive into his hands, and I drive the nail in, and I hear his cries of pain reverberating in my entire insides, from my heart and all other areas. I see his eyes again, and his eyes show me love for me. This is just too much. I have so much self-disgust. Who am I? What have I done? My world has just flipped upside down. I know what I feel, and I am not the man I pretend to be anymore, regardless of the consequences. I have to honour my feelings. I'm done. I'm not a man of this anymore. I know who I am, and I'm afraid. My mother, the one who showed me love, the only thing I needed to know, is the only one who will understand and hope, and I hope that this God that this man speaks of too will understand. I have nowhere to go. I believe in love, and I know I will die now. I cannot hide. No one will touch me. The uniform I used to wear has tainted me. Even if the person underneath it is not the same representation of the so-called power over others that the uniform imposes. No one knows me except as to stay away. How false it all is. I have been bred, nurtured and grown as an icon of fear, yet I am love. No one knows me. No one will accept me. For what I have done and stood up for has led to my total isolation for me. I have only me now until they find me. I have nowhere to go. Surrender is the only thing I have left. That's all I have left, the only power I have left. The taunts, the anger, the animal behaviours are all mine now. Directed at me, that means. All that I have given out is coming back to me as if by all that I have done it to. The soldiers hate one of their own with more passion and more exuberance than any which has crossed them, especially in my rank. Their vengeance is frantic. They break me. Always known and otherwise they invent with new enthusiasm for inflicting pain. I want it to end, but it keeps on going on as if everyone I have killed or harmed is taking their turn. They keep me alive so the pain can last as long as possible. This is what I thought. I hung upside down because I stayed alive. It was my own will that kept me alive. I wrote, I hang upside down because blood goes to your head so you can't faint. They have broken my body beyond repair. My insides are now on the ground. I can see them. I know it's not far away now. At some time of all this, I know I saw my mother's eyes. They're in the crowd. I saw them. I saw the deep sadness and love that I knew was real. It was no myth. All I hear is my breath now. It's all I have left to tell that I'm still in this world. I hope that this man was right and I go into his kingdom of God now. It's time to go. And that was it.
Wow.
So when Corny arrived in the spirit world, it was like with a deep disappointment, because he felt initially that I'd lied to him, that you know, because he passed into the hells, he didn't go to the kingdom of God. He went into these hellish places, and so initially his reaction was one of like just total disbelief of anything for some time. He couldn't believe that even what was being told to him about love and God's kingdom and all those things.
So once I found out the truth, it became a lie straight away again.
Yeah.
It felt like just what is ever real. It's become even worse, not knowing. You know, you think you believe something, it's all good, and then all of a sudden it's not. You know, where are you at? Just didn't know some deeper truths, that was all. I knew my love was real in the end. We kept on looking for that in the end and got me through.
Mm. Yeah. So a lot of times when people pass, they pass into places that they didn't expect, you know, and it causes so much disillusionment. But if they knew the truth, if they knew the whole truth, they wouldn't be disillusioned, you know, they would actually know that where they are is a reflection of their soul, and all they need to do is work through their soul's emotions and they'll get to a different place, and they'd know all of those things, you know. But because of the untruth that exists on the earth, there's this big untruth that exists here on the earth of, you know, when you die, you all of a sudden become all-knowing. You know, and that's one of the worst untruths on earth that there is, because people pass with that expectation. And imagine that, if you had that expectation in you and then passed, just how... To how crushing it would be to find yourself in the first sphere, or in the hells of the first sphere even, for a period of time, if you believed that.
That's what my mum believed when she passed. The angels were going to come and get her and take her up.
A lot of people do.
Most people do, yeah. And then there's these New Age philosophies of when you die, you just automatically have a life review and then you come back for the next one, right? And that teaching causes so much trouble here on earth, because a lot of people try to come back into bodies that are somebody else's body. Right? And so what happens is that you get this spirit possession thing going on over and over and over again, because these spirits think that they have to come back. It's the only way to experience life from now on. And it's quite sad, really, that a lot of the things that are going on earth, and a lot of the things going on in the first sphere, are the results of just teachings of error about what is really happening. And it's so important to correct error. And it's so important to address error whenever you get the opportunity. And just one statement of truth to a person can change their whole life. Just one statement of truth.
AJ, is it true that there's no power in the spirit world, but the power is here to make changes? Is that true?
The truth is that you have power everywhere to make changes. So there is you have just as much power here as you do in the spirit world, and the spirits have just as much power in the spirit world to change as we do here. And one of the really sad teachings of Christianity is that once you die, you're condemned or you're saved. Because the problem with that teaching is that it teaches you that you cannot get out of the condition that you're now in. So a lot of spirit people pass into the spirit world believing that where they now are, they must stay for eternity. That is their torture, if you like. And it's such a damaging teaching. It just takes years and years and years of effort of spirits who are in a higher place to get through to that person that they do not have to stay in that place. It's just such a, you know, there are so many of these teachings that affect what happens in the person's life, their eternal life, for so long. There is so much pain going on in the first sphere of the spirit world right now that doesn't need to happen at all because of these teachings that we're holding on to here on earth and then taking with us when we pass. And that's why truth is just so important.
Let's say I pass tomorrow. I've got all this error. I've got some love. So do I pass into the place that represents my error? Or is there an average between the two? How does that work?
It's a good question. Yeah. Your soul is in a certain condition of love. There's two types of love, remember. What are they?
Natural love. Natural
love. Right, so there's the two types of love. Now, the natural love is all about morals or morality. And divine love is all about receiving God's love into your heart, right? Now, you can receive some divine love, but still have moral error. Right? And at some point, you will have to be confronted with that error to progress beyond that point. Now, what often happens is that we might pass, and there'll be we'll be in a place that matches our soul condition in love. So let's say right now your soul could be in a third sphere state. So you will pass and you can go to the third sphere. But let's say I've got a heap of rage in me still, which is like almost a first sphere rage, right? Well, I will be visiting the first sphere at different times, and that rage will be triggered and released. All right. So while your home might be in the third sphere, you may find initially that you don't spend hardly any time there at all, and you spend most of your time where your emotional injuries are. You deal with those emotional injuries, and then the home that's prepared for you is, by the way, not prepared for you. You prepared it, believe it or not. And the home that you have prepared for yourself by your life here, you will be able to live in, wherever that be.
So you go to where you've developed your love, not where your errors are. Is that
you go where you've developed your love, but yes, it's the real part of your love. See, a lot of times we're receiving spirit love from spirits, which we then think is our love. And,
I see.
Do you know what I mean? We often have often right at the moment, we'll have an inconsistent concept or an incorrect concept about what my true loving condition is right now.
Because we receive love from spirits.
Because you're receiving love from spirits, so at times you feel loving and you reflect that love. And so then you start thinking that it might be a part of your own love.
I see.
But all of God's laws work on your soul condition,
right,
not anybody else's. So that's why the majority of people on earth pass into the first sphere, because it works on your own soul condition.
Yeah.
Now the key is for you to start addressing the emotions that cause you. Now if you just the idea of having a feeling inside of yourself of wanting to look at your emotions puts you in a different condition of love. Do you understand that? Like, so just you having a desire to feel your own emotions places you in a higher condition of love. Because the majority of persons don't want to feel their own emotions. What do they want to do with them?
Suppress them.
They want to suppress them. What else?
Deny them.
Project them.
Project them. They want other people to look after them, generally, don't they? That is an unloving space. So as soon as you even get into the condition where you even just want to feel your own emotions, straight away you're in a better space.
Even if you're not feeling them.
Even if you're not feeling them yet. Right? You are already in a better condition than you were just moments before choosing to not feel them. So every single change you make causes your condition to change straight away. Every single change you make towards divine truth causes your condition to shift. And every shift you make means that obviously when you pass into the spirit world, you would pass into a different location. And every one of you right now is preparing a home for yourself in the spirit world. In the first century, I used to say to people, I'm going my way to prepare a place for you. In my father's house, there are many mansions. Right? And what I was referring to was that every one of you have a home, and some of you even have mansions in the spirit world, right, where you are developed in love enough to actually exist in those locations when you're in your sleep state. Right? Some of you will even have dreams of your home in the spirit world. Have any of you had that, where you've had a dream of a really nice location and you've woken up wondering where that is? Yeah, well, that's your home in the spirit world.
I shook my head. I haven't. I'm always in darkness.
Corny's really dark.
Inside our place, Corny.
I'll come visit you in my sleep. George, you went party on there. My place sucks.
Can I ask another question?
Sure.
You've helped me realise that on my visits to the Oneness University, I had some really high experiences. Sometimes they last for weeks. And I started feeling like when you're in a state of joy for 3 weeks, you start feeling like it's permanent.
Yes.
And you've helped me realize that that wasn't necessarily the love I'd developed. So that helped me become more honest and real.
Yeah.
Because then I would drop down into some dark states.
Yeah.
I've got people that I can talk to sometimes who, one I'm thinking of in particular, who lives in a beautiful state. And because he lives in a beautiful state, he doesn't feel he has to develop a relationship with God, because he already feels he's at one with God.
Yep.
And I can look back and see how I was heading in that direction.
Yes. Yep.
And I can see how
you can see how
delusional.
Delude yourself into a state.
Yes.
And this is where every sixth sphere spirit is, actually. They're in a self-deluded state of being God. So they feel so much love within themselves and so much joy within themselves that now they believe they are God themselves. Or they call themselves a fragment of God, some of them, but a lot of them just call themselves God. And you can get into that state, and it's a totally self-delusional state. It's not real.
In a sense, that's like the ultimate curse, isn't it? Because longer you're there, the harder it is to get out of it.
Yeah, in the first century I called it the greatest sin. The greatest sin is the sin against the Holy Spirit. The sin against the Holy Spirit is when you decide to not receive divine love that's being offered to you because you believe you're already there, that come to you, and you'll be able to express your natural love. The main difference, though, between love in the sixth sphere state or on the natural love path and love in the divine state is that love in the sixth sphere state is very principled-based.
Yes.
Do you know what I mean by that?
Yeah. Yeah.
What I mean by that is that if you see a principle of truth, mm-hmm. you act upon it whether you feel the emotion in your heart or not. Mm-hmm. Do you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
So let's say somebody was smacking their child in our audience. Now, all of you will have different emotions about that, but intellectually you would know the principle that the child is just reflecting the emotions of its parents in the audience in the first place. So therefore, how can you punish a child for reflecting something that the parents are actually denying within themselves, right? So you would say that you could see that them smacking him might not be such a good idea. It's quite a damaging thing to do, in fact, to the child. But you could then go up to the person and say to them, do you think you should be doing that or whatever? All just coming from your intellect, couldn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Now, you're acting in love, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
Because you're acting based on the principle. And the principle in this case is what the Greeks used to call agape love, which is love based on principle. So in other words, I follow principles, and that's what causes me to love. Now, on the divine love path, it's totally different than that. You will watch that event, and you'll feel cut to the heart about what's happening to the child. You'll feel an emotion inside of yourself, right? And it won't be just based on the principle anymore. It'll come from your heart that's been opened in love. Do you follow me?
Mm-hmm.
There's a big difference between those two states. One is very principled love. The other is a love that generates from the emotional state, from the heart, right? And what happens on the divine love path is all of the love you express comes from your heart. It comes from your heart and is expressed. And in its expression, it is based around some of the principles on the natural love path, but it's a totally different feeling within the person. It's driven by the feeling, not by the thought of the principle. So when I talk to six fear spirits now, I feel them to be very harsh at times, very uncompromising, because they're very principled. And they're not connecting at the heart level. Do you know what I mean? They're connecting at the mind level, but not the heart level.
They wouldn't even know how to do that, though.
Well, they don't know how to do it. That's part of the problem. And the issue is, when you connect at the mind level, you do act based on principles that you've learned, but you don't act from the heart. All right? And so what I find, talking to many six fear spirits, like I'll say to them, well, why did you let that person believe you were somebody else? Like, quite often a six-fear spirit will connect to a person on earth like a medium and then let the person on earth believe they were somebody else. In the oneness movement, that happens a bit with letting them believe they're God.
Mm.
You know, the spirit believes he's God,
mm.
and so he connects with a person. So let's say I'm the spirit and I believe I'm God. I'm a six-fear spirit, I believe I'm God. And Peter's longing for divine love, for God's love, or what he thinks is God's love, and he thinks it's to do with this. And so I come along and I give him my love and I call it God's love. Right? Now, I haven't broken any principles inside of myself, have I? But I have broken a principle of truth. Right? Unbeknown to myself. Right? And the principle of truth is God can only give God's love.
But they
firstly,
don't know that.
And God is an entity. But I don't know that. I might not know that. Or I might know God is an entity, but I'm thinking that I'm acting on God's behalf.
Right.
Or I might know God's an entity and I'm actually acting on God's behalf, but I know that inside of you, you think it's something different than what I'm doing.
Mm.
Now, would a person who really loves you from the heart want that for you?
No.
They wouldn't, would they?
No.
They'd want you to understand the truth of what's happening, then we're fine, then the transaction's fine. You follow me?
Mm.
And so a lot of times what happens with six-fear spirit transactions or spirit transactions on the natural love path is they withhold truth, right, until they think you're ready to hear it. And by the way, when you decide to withhold truth from somebody until you think they're ready to hear it. How many times have you done that in the day? Right? Then you are actually acting in the same manner as these spirits are acting. Can you see how it develops really easily, that kind of attitude? But that is a natural love attitude. A divine love attitude is, how can I let you believe an untruth without, and me be a party to it? I would feel cut to the heart about that, wouldn't I, at the divine love level, and you know, at a heartfelt emotional level, I would feel cut to the heart that I've been a part of you believing an untruth. And so if I'm actually connecting emotionally with God, and I've got God's love flowing through me, I would not even allow that circumstance to develop. I'd do everything I possibly could to tell the person something different. I'd maintain the connection, but try to help the person come to truth. Can you see the difference between the two states?
Sure. Yeah. But isn't truth coloured by the injuries that you still have within your being?
Well, our personal truth certainly is, but God's truth isn't. And this is the principle we need to all grasp, is that divine truth is God's truth, and it's not coloured by our personal experience. Our truth is our personal truth, and quite often it's error. Mm. Quite often it's what is erroneous that is now within us that we believe to be true. And the key for us is to learn how to tell the difference. And that's very hard at sometimes, isn't it, like, to tell the difference. You know? So let's say your husband comes home and yells at you. What does your truth say? Give him a blast back, right? You know, that's not very just. He should, if he's going to yell at me, I'll give him a blast back. You know, that's our justice, right? That's our truth. We feel like giving him a blast back, so we do. Is it divine truth?
No,
because if we were in a state of love, we wouldn't feel like giving him a blast back, would we?
So at all. What do you do? Just sit there and take it?
It is a legitimate question for sure. And yes, if you're in a divine love state, you would sit there and take it, and you wouldn't even think it's taking it. You wouldn't even think it, because to you it's like nothing is happening, really. Emotionally, you know exactly what's going on within him. You know what's most... You probably say to him, well, yeah, you've got some emotions there, haven't you, Mal? You've got some emotions there, haven't you?
And so if it does register as taking it, or, you know, an imposition, then that means you've still got stuff within you.
Totally.
Okay.
Yep, totally. Yep. Yeah. And once you're in an abundant state with God, you won't feel like you're taking anything from anyone. Like I've been tortured, right? And I didn't at the time feel I was taking anything from anyone. And that's the state you'll be in. That state. It's a wonderful state to be in.
So what state you're in now?
No.
What level are you at now?
Well, when I'm as angry as I am now, I'm back in the third sphere, I think. But generally, in the seventh sphere condition, I've been in the seventh sphere condition for nearly 3 years now.
So, AJ, in that scenario, you've recognised you're taking it, and you've recognised the stuff within you. Does that let the other person off the hook? You know what I mean? Like,
you
recognise that you've got the stuff, so it's resonating with you, but you're still receiving.
Let's look at the emotion off the hook, letting them off the hook. How many of you feel that if you were taking something from somebody and without giving something back to them, taking some anger from them without giving a bit of anger back or whatever, how many of you feel that you would let them get away with it? Quite a few will feel that if you're honest, like I so often. Now, that feeling of letting somebody get away from it is also a false belief in itself. Because who does God let anybody get away with anything? So can they really get away with it in the end? They can't, can they? Right.
Haven't you also talked though about not allowing people to treat you unloving in an unloving way?
Yeah, but let's say somebody was treating you unlovingly, right? You were in a abundant state with God. Not even feel a single piece of pain about that. So if I'm feeling a bit of pain about that, then I'm obviously firstly not in an at-one-ment state with God, but secondly, I'm also in a state where I still need to deal with some kind of emotion from it, because the law of attraction's working where I'm getting that from them, right? Yeah. So certainly remove yourself, that's fine, because that's an act of love towards yourself. Remove yourself from the situation, but focus on your own emotion about it. It's not them that's caused all this. It's your own emotion, it's your own attraction. Does that make sense? Certainly remove yourself, because it's an act of love to do it. Remove yourself until you can be in a better state of love where you don't need to. You will need to do that, and then allow yourself to work through the emotion that caused the attraction. Yeah. And then once you do that, you'll be able to sit in a whole auditorium of people yelling at you and not feel a single thing from it. And still feel happy within yourself. And it won't be an intellectual getting away from it. You'll feel your own emotion. You'll know exactly what emotions are being directed at you. They just will not resonate with you anymore.
Once you get to the cause.
Once you get to the cause and release it all. Yeah.
So shouting, like if I shout now, purely sort of scientifically, it's uncomfortable. So it's uncomfortable. Are you saying that it's not, that that's still something that's resonating? Because, so if someone's shouting, like, he's so shouting,
but see, that's not owning the law of attraction. That's not owning your law of attraction. This person's shouting at you in an angry voice because of your law of attraction.
So you're saying, oh, but he says, I have to deal with everything, and then they won't be shouting at
you. If you deal with the emotion you feel, they will automatically stop shouting at you, generally. Yeah, it did.
He did attract
it. Yeah. I wasn't stoned to death, but yeah, I did attract it. Because there's also attractions based on truth. When you're in a state of truth, what do people need to confront their error? Truth. So when you're in a state of truth, you will automatically attract people who are in error. And who at the soul level want to deal with that error at some point.
Sort of sounds like there's no escape. Like when you're in error, you attract pain. When you're in truth, you attract pain too.
Yeah, but it's not like that. When you're in a state of bliss, you don't think of it as that.
It's a different experience.
It's a totally different experience. Mm-hmm. Someone can be yelling at you. Someone can stone you or slap you or hit you. It just has no effect on you. No negative effect on you.
There's more of a compassion towards them of realizing the state they're in. It's kind of, you're not affected by it, but you can understand where they're kind of like the hurt that's bringing all this stuff up. You can do that.
But if you were in a state of bliss, if you were in a state of at one with God, presumably you wouldn't attract.
Well, you won't attract many of those events, and obviously, the first person who gets in the state attracts more than anybody else, of course. So if there's 100 people in that state, then you're going to attract less, right? And if there's 1,000, the 1,000 will attract less individually. But in the first century, like in my death, like Corny was hammering the nail into my wrist, and I was projecting love at him so much that he had to drop his hammer and leave. Right? So how did that happen?
Power of love.
So it's the love that I didn't feel him hammering. Him hammering the nails into my wrist wasn't a hurtful thing to me. It didn't hurt me. And I could still feel love for him doing it.
Hurt me.
It hurt Corny. Mm. It hurt Corny a lot. But it didn't hurt me.
Physically and emotionally.
It didn't hurt me physically or emotionally. Physically, because you can control all of your body's physiological functions when you're in a state of atonement with God. Emotionally, because there was no emotions that were being triggered. Right? So it was just an event. It was an event, a neutral event for me. But obviously, I've had pleasurable events that are not neutral, that I'd prefer. You know, I would have much preferred having sex with my soulmate or something. but the event itself was neutral from a physical and an emotional perspective. and I could still be in a state of love where I felt love for Cornelius as he was doing it. Right, so much so that it affected his heart so much that caused him to stop actually doing it. But that being said, I projected the same amount of love at the man who hammered the nails into my feet, and it had no effect on him whatsoever. Because he wasn't open to experiencing love, whereas Corny in his heart was open to the experience of love now. His, as he described in the previous writings that he just read out to you, his mother and the connection there with his mum and what he'd heard from me over the period of a few years had caused shifts in his soul to actually expose it or open up his soul enough to want love again. And so the instant somebody projected love at him, he was willing to receive it in his heart. And so it flowed into him. Whereas the man who was nailing the nail into my feet, you know, he wasn't in that state. He's just totally impervious to any projection of love.
Yeah. While we're still alive here on Earth, can our soul's condition skip certain spheres, or is it the progression, one that goes, say, to third, fourth, fifth, sixth, or can your soul's condition improve, say, dramatically?
Depends what you call dramatically. If you're talking about instant progression, the answer is no. There's no such thing as instant progression of the soul.
That's a shame.
And if it happens that way, it's always a spirit causing the change of state. So it's not real.
In the sixth sphere?
It might be a spirit in a lower sphere, but you know, if I'm in the first sphere and there's a spirit in the third sphere influencing me, I'll feel like I'm in the third sphere. If I'm a medium connecting to that spirit, I'll believe I'm actually in the third sphere. I'll believe I'm in a good state. But in reality, I won't be. My soul condition determines the state I'm in. You will, but on Earth, the lessons you learn are sort of a bit haphazard. What I mean by that is that there might be, a third sphere lesson. One of the third sphere lessons is to come to love truth above anything else. That's the divine love lesson in the third sphere. Now, you may progress to the fourth sphere on the natural love path and then learn that lesson, right? So, or you might learn that lesson in the bottom of the hells. Can you see that? Like, I might be on Earth here in a terrible state and then just make a choice to just make my focus truth above all else and just feel that change of inside of my heart. I've learnt a third sphere lesson, but it doesn't mean I'm in the third sphere. I'm still in the first sphere having to work through emotions, but I've learnt a third sphere lesson. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Everyone? A fifth sphere lesson is generally soulmate. Fourth and fifth sphere lessons, there's a lot of soulmate lessons in there, right? But I can learn a lot of them in the first sphere, on the earth in particular. But many don't, and they are forced into learning them at a certain part in the progression.
But we're not actually in a sphere until we're in the spirit world, are we?
Yes, we are. We are in a sphere right now. Right now you are in a sphere. Your spirit body and your soul condition puts you in a certain location of love. Every night you go to sleep, that's the location you dwell in. Every night. You are progressing right now, and you are in that sphere right now.
It's just simply a condition of love.
It's a physical dimensional space and a condition of love at the same time. And every night you go to sleep, you go into that sphere where your soul condition already resides.
Are they different? Is it called different things to what you're labelling after you die?
All of the terminology I'm using is used in the celestial kingdom. So there are lots of different terminology used in the sixth sphere. So the sixth sphere, there's literally thousands and thousands of different descriptions for the same thing. In the celestial.
What you were just talking about with that lady about here, us being in a sphere condition, is there a different language to label that, and would you talk more about it?
I just use the language we've used.
How you're doing, you know what I mean?
To know how you're doing. Why do you want to know how you're doing?
Well, because I want to get better.
You know, it's because of another emotion. What's the emotion?
Yeah, fear. It's a fear of failure, fear of not doing enough, lots of worry about.
So my most loving action would be to not give you an answer and let you feel that fear of failure and let you feel the fear that you're not going as well as you're hoping.
Okay.
Yep. Can everyone see that? Like every question you ask is based around an emotion that you often we often are not facing, right? And so oftentimes it's not wise to give an answer, and this is why spirits with you might not give you an answer either, because you need to face the emotion, not get the answer. After you face the emotion, then they'll give you the answer, right? And the truth is that after you face your emotions, God gives you the truth as well.
You don't need the question.
Yeah, and then you don't need the question in the first place.
So would reading the Paget messages help you in your understanding of third sphere truth, insights?
All we need to, like, the beauty of the Paget messages and reading them on a daily basis is that it keeps your heart open. It keeps your soul open to truth. That's the beauty of it. And there'll be things you read today that you don't understand at all. And then in 6 months' time, after you've worked through different things, you read it again and you're blown away by it, because your heart's now in a new space. But the beauty of just rereading a lot of these things and going through it is that it can open you up a lot emotionally. And I've personally found it very helpful for me to just keep reading these things over and over and over again. And every time I have new emotional experiences as a result. But what you do is, like, up to you in terms of your progress. And a lot of people don't like to read, right? And so if that's the case, play music and let your heart open, you know, or do something else that makes your heart open. Do some art that makes your heart open towards God. Whatever, you know, whatever grabs you that actually causes you to connect emotionally, do that. With me, I found it just reading the messages keeps me nice and connected with my spirit friends, helps me just feel different emotions that are going on within me, opens me up. And I did that for a long time. Now I don't do that as much. Now what I do now is just live in the moment, just letting what emotions come, letting the different connections flow, and just letting it trigger me in the moment. But there's been many times in my progression where I've done lots and lots of reading and kept myself in a state where I'm open. Yeah. All can be very helpful to you. There's another thing that you might find interesting that I just thought I'd mention as well. There's a channeling that was done in 1948 about the reappearance of the Christ. Mm-hmm. It's by Dwell Cull, who's the spirit, and transcribed by Alice Bailey.
Yes.
You've heard of Alice Bailey?
Yeah.
Yep. It's about 50 or 60 pages, I think. 60 pages or so. It describes this whole thing of, you know, the 14 reappearing on earth, basically. It talks about Christ and the masters of wisdom appearing on earth. And I'm not saying that we're masters of wisdom or anything, but this is channeled by a sixth sphere spirit. So it's not channeled by a divine love spirit. It's a six-year look at what's going to be happening on the earth. Does that make sense?
Yep.
But it's a very interesting read. I've found it quite interesting because it actually contains some of my own emotions about my feelings now. And I've found it quite handy for me.
And is that on the
web? I don't know if it is actually. I'll email it out in my next email. I'll just email a copy of it. By the way, it is copyrighted, so I probably shouldn't be emailing it out. But,
just scrap that bit in the camera there.
I don't know who holds the copyright anymore. She died, this lady died quite some time ago. But I think there's a corporation or a trust or something. The Lucas Trust, that's it. So you can actually get the book on the net if you want to read it.
Isn't copyright only an issue if you're selling it at a profit?
No, it's also an issue of just photocopying it or something. It depends in different countries, but yeah. Very interesting read, though, for someone. The reason why I bring it up is because it actually outlines a six-sphere perspective of what is going to be happening on the Earth.
Is it accurate?
And there's a lot of accuracy in it, yeah. Not the underlying causes of that it describes are not correct. Because all causes are soul level based, right?
Yeah.
And the six sphere spirit generally doesn't understand soul level causes. So they are looking at everything from a very metaphysical point of view. But it's still a very interesting read.
So a six sphere spirit based on 1948, making those predictions.
Yeah, in 1948 these predictions were made. Yeah.
What's the name again?
It's called The Reappearance of the Christ. Oh, this is my printout, sir. The spirit is Dwalkal, which is D-J-W-H-A-L-K-H-U-L. And the lady who wrote it is Alice Bailey. If you just search for Alice Bailey on the net, you'll find it. Yeah.
So how did the person make that prediction in 1940s? Can they look into the future and see what's going to happen?
Yeah, and also in 1945, around about, I did announce to the spirit world that I would be returning to Earth. So, yeah, by then I knew how that would be accomplished, and so I did make an announcement to all the spirit world, including the sixth sphere, that I would be returning to Earth.
Couple of your mates.
With a couple of my mates. This master of wisdom.
So how do spirits in the sixth sphere who don't even know about the divine love path or any of the celestial realms come to terms with that information? I mean, how do they rationalise it away?
Yeah, that's what they do. They rationalise it away.
How? What do they say?
All sorts of methods of denial of their own emotion. Yeah. It's quite sad sometimes watching it happen, because they'll have all sorts of things going on. Like, you've heard of the Urantia book?
Yeah.
Most of you would have heard of that.
Yeah.
The Urantia book contains a whole description of my life in the first century, and some of it's accurate, and a fair portion of it's inaccurate. But it was channeled by a six-sphere spirit to a person on Earth in 1933 or 4. 2,000 pages of intellectual, I don't want to call it crap.
That's another copy of the Bible.
No, it's bigger than the Bible. It's like twice the size of the Bible. Yeah, twice the size of the Bible. Really, really intellectual. Really intellectual. Most people struggle to read it. The portion that contains my life is part four, and there's about 400 or 500 pages of that. And a lot of it is, again, six-sphere interpretation of what happened in my life, not what actually happened in my life, but their interpretation of what happened in my life. Because as you progress more and more in truth, you get more of a clear concept of what's going on in the universe around you. So there are books in the six-sphere, actually. Did you know that? There's books in the spirit world that you can read, which are, there's literally millions of them, that you can read about all sorts of subjects. But they'll all be the truth as seen by a sixth sphere spirit. Then in the seventh sphere, there's a whole lot of other books. And those books have all the corrections of the books. And other stuff. And then in the first celestial, which is the eighth sphere, it's the same, and so forth and so forth.
So in the pageant messages, it says that there's not going to be a second coming. So what happened between...
What happened was that I did actually mention in the pageant messages how a second coming would occur. I talked about it. Some of the channelings that I did about it were removed, but some of the channelings there about how the soul would have to be in a union state before it could return. But I felt even then that would never occur. So all of the spirits who were even channeling the stuff in the pageant messages were channeling what we believe to be true at that point in time.
So what sphere were you in then?
I was in around the 19th sphere. So, and I was channeling, and I was in the higher sphere at that time that was ever created. And I was channeling information back to Earth based on my beliefs of what was happening at that location. But I actually said that as well in the pageant messages. James Paget asked all sorts of questions, and some of the questions I said I couldn't even answer because I hadn't even learnt the answer to it yet. So I was telling, and John, the Apostle John, also said that in some of his messages. So the key thing with all truth is to bear in mind that whatever a person tells you, including myself, tells you, you may need to modify it down the track. Right? The only person that you won't need to modify truth from is God. Right? All of our conceptions of truth are going to be different at different stages. So in the 22nd sphere state, I have conceptions of truth that are higher states than the 22nd sphere state, but I can't prove any of it because I've not experienced it. Does that make sense? And when I experience it, then I'll be able to prove it. And if I'm not the first one, somebody else will do it, and they'll be able to teach me, hopefully. You know? And that's how it works. So allow yourself to understand that truth is never set in stone.
God's truth is.
God's truth is, but our progression towards truth is never set in stone.
AJ, is your progression stopped now in terms of your progression in the 22nd sphere? Now that you're back here, or can you simultaneously progress in that state as well as being here?
You can't progress beyond the 21st sphere without being in a complete soul union state with your soulmate. So until I'm in that state here on Earth, I will be 22nd sphere state.
And stop there. Whereas all the other souls that are in that state could actually keep progressing with
you. Yeah. Yeah.
With their soul partner.
With their soulmate. They have become one soul now, and they could, yeah. So some of them could right now progress into a higher state and then show me what to do. And I'm okay with that. In fact, I'd be very okay with that. At the moment, I'd be extremely okay. Right. Yeah. Like the whole... One of the hardest emotions I've had to deal with is this feeling of being the first, now that I'm back to Earth. A lot of times I had a lot of joy with that, but now I'm back on Earth in the state I'm in now, I just feel like it's a drag. Like I want someone else to be the first and they just tell me. It makes it a bit easier. So, yes, you know, some of the emotions I have now are pretty different to what I was experiencing when I was there experiencing those things in the spirit world.
And do all your 22nd sphere abilities of manifestation and bilocation, all of that only come when you get into a state of at one and
with your soulmate? Yes.
Oh, yeah. I thought with God.
Oh no, with the one-ment with God occurs in the 8th sphere.
Yeah.
So that's the half of the soul now in one-ment with God, but the one-ment with your soulmate occurs in the 22nd sphere. So in between the 8th sphere and the 22nd sphere, there's a lot of truths, right, to learn about love, about divine love. But none of them are painful.
You're asking about manifestation, though.
No, I'm talking about how, like, over in India, the avatars have the ability to, bring people back from the dead and be in contact with tens of thousands of people simultaneously and help them in all different ways at all different times. All they've got to do is call on them.
Well, firstly, you can't bring someone back from the dead.
Well, if the cord isn't broken.
Right. So if you're talking about the cord, the silver cord being broken from the spirit body and the material body, then nobody can bring anybody back from the dead in any circumstance.
Right.
So if people are bringing back people from the dead, it's just a spirit, like it is a spirit who's doing all of these things through them because of their mediumistic connection. And what's happening is they're just manifesting things or doing things in a metaphysical way, which any six-sphere spirit can do. So...
What's the purpose?
Like, in the end, all it does is create fascination. Mm-hmm. But does it help you grow in divine love, really? Might give you a bit of faith, maybe. So that the way they look at it is, we're giving people faith on Earth that this is real. But the truth is that it's not real yet. It's looking like the person on Earth is doing it, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is that the person on Earth isn't doing it, because the person on Earth, if they didn't have the spirit connection, is not in the sixth sphere state to do it. You follow me?
Yeah.
So it's actually the sixth sphere spirit who's doing it, making it look like the person on Earth doing it, to give you some faith. But it's all, like to me, it's all a bit false, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Like, really, what is it doing? It's really creating a fictional state that you believe in. I'd much rather just say the truth of what's going on. And let's get to the at-one-ment condition, and all of us can do those things, and it won't be fictional. It'll be actually really you, through your desire and your passion, and you will be doing it. And you won't need a six-sphere spirit to help you do it.
Virtually every so-called spiritual experience that is written about in the literature and longed for by people are all spirit influence and from the sixth sphere. And
well, not just the sixth sphere, a lot of them from lower spheres as well.
I see.
But yes, all healing that happens now is all related to spirits doing the healing. Right? There's no one on earth currently healing with because of being in an one-ment condition with God in divine love. They are all just people on earth are in a good mediumistic condition, getting energy through a spirit. The spirit's using the ectoplasm of the person to heal the other person. That's what's going on. There's nothing wrong with it, and particularly if someone's getting healed. But when I say nothing wrong, our definitions of what's right and wrong change on the divine love path as well. Because on the divine love path, the person who's getting healed is already in the state where they're not healed. They've got an issue because of what? An emotion that they're not. Now, if I heal them, what are they going to think?
They don't have to do anything.
Right? So can you see that that creates a problem, doesn't it, in a way, on the divine path?
It's
sort of dishonest in a way. And that's why God doesn't heal them. See, the question people need to be asking themselves is, why doesn't God heal me? The answer is really quite simple. When you're ready to deal with the emotion that caused the illness, God will heal you at that instant, and you won't need a spirit to help him. He can heal you straight at that time, as soon as you're willing to deal with that emotion. You follow me? So this is how God wants to connect with all of his children. Why would he want to connect through some person in the Middle East or some person in India to heal a heap of people and have thousands of people paying thousands of dollars to get there? Why would God want that? God wants to love all of his children, doesn't he? So what does he want? He wants all of you to experience this instantaneous healing that is possible when you're willing to deal with the causal emotion that creates the issue. That's what he wants.
So what about your healings in the first century, healing lepers and stuff like that?
The only persons I healed in the first century were willing to deal with the emotions at that moment. So like, there's an account in the Bible that's a fairly accurate account of my healing 10 blind men, and 9 of them just ran off and did other things and weren't even thankful, and the 10th one was thankful, right? Now, what actually happened was that all of them, before they were being healed, all of them were in a state where they wanted to deal with the emotion of why they had blindness. All of them were in that state. Now, some of it was parental emotion, some of it was related to their life and so forth. Now, all of them were in that state at that time, but as soon as you heal someone, often a person thinks, what would you think? You get healed.
I don't need to worry about that emotion anymore.
That's easy.
Now you're starting to feel like, maybe I don't need to worry about that emotion, right? And you know, and so a person's emotional state changes just in the act of getting healed sometimes too. Sometimes their emotional state actually becomes worse in that they become less thankful, right? Other times they become more thankful. It just depends on what's going to happen and what their choices are. Now, when you're healing a person, you're not responsible for the choices they make after you've healed them. You're only responsible, if you could say the word responsible at all, for their choices that they're making right now. So that's why in some cases I did heal people in the first century, but afterwards they showed a thankless attitude. That didn't mean that at the time that they're being healed they showed that. Often it was afterwards that they, you know, they felt, oh, that was easy, you know, oh, I've got my life back now. For many of them, particularly the lepers, and that was the case, you know. You imagine being, you know, 20 or 30 years with leprosy, being like in a constant state of uncleanness under Israelite law. Nobody would touch you even, so you hadn't been touched for 30 years. Imagine that, except by another leper, the only person who could touch you. You imagine being in that state and then all of a sudden being healed. Now, you'd really want to get out of that state and you'd be really wanting to address the emotion, wouldn't you, at that time that you had the prospect of being healed, wouldn't you? But imagine you're instantly healed. What would you do then? You see, a lot of them said, oh, I've got my life back now. I can go and do, like, how many of them? For 30 years, they haven't had sex, many of them. So what do you reckon is the next thing they do? Right? Or for 30 years, they haven't been able to be with their mates or, you know, eat a meal with people. What are they? So they become so engrossed in that that they forget what just happened. And that's really easy to occur.
Does the condition come back then if they haven't dealt with the emotion?
Certainly.
Did all those 9 blind people?
Oh, it depends what caused the emotions. Sometimes it would be a parent-based thing where they're blind at birth, when if that's the case, very much a parent, so that wouldn't return. But it just depends on what created their blindness in the first place. So there's many illnesses with people that I healed at the time, completely healed, but years later they developed the same condition and died. Yeah.
You believe there's an emotional cause behind all disease?
Yes. Yeah, there is an emotional cause behind every single disease, every single illness, every accident that happens to you, every cut that you get, every, like, absolutely everything that goes on in your life, there's an emotional cause inside of you.
That's pretty overwhelming.
You are completely responsible for everything you create. I'm not saying you're to blame, I'm just saying you're responsible. Firstly, the act of the car crash was caused by the law of attraction. Something was going on inside of yourself that created that event, firstly. And not only inside of yourself, by the way, all law of attraction events occur through the interaction of hundreds of different of law of attractions. And sometimes thousands and sometimes millions of people's law of attraction all acting together. You follow me? That creates the event. So let's say the event's created, I get brain damage. If I get brain damage, there's a high likelihood now I'll be in the sleep state condition, like an out-of-body condition, until my body dies. So there are two sorts of things that happen in brain damage generally. One is that I go into an out-of-body condition, which is like, you know, I'm in the spirit world mostly until my physical body passes, and then I'll stay in the spirit world permanently. Or the second condition is I go into a state of sort of unconsciousness in the spirit form as well. So it's like all of that. All the stuff I'm doing from then on, a lot of it, depending on how severe the brain damage, a lot of it I don't even know, even in the spirit world. So it's like a black part of my life that I don't feel any emotions either generally at that point, nothing changes. It's sort of like, you can also almost liken it to a suspended animation sort of a feeling emotionally. There was a really good book, Howard Stern's Personal Experience. Who's read that? It's called...
Howard Storm or Stern?
Howard Storm. Stern or Storm?
Stern.
Stern, I think it is. Stern. What's the book called? Sorry?
Anatomy of an
Illness? No, this one's a different book. This is the book of his transformation. What happened is he nearly died, and he had an out-of-body experience when he nearly died. And his soul condition was hellish at the time, and he experienced some of the hells, and he actually wrote about it. But I can't remember the name of the book.
From Descent to Death?
Descent into Death, that's it. Yeah, that's a very interesting book to read, particularly the first, say, 5 or 6 chapters I reckon. After that it gets very... A lot of these books, you know, the first 5 or 6 chapters are really interesting. And then after that they get very metaphysical explanation of what's going on and what's happening. It gets all very intellectual after that, and you sort of lose interest in it.